that I had hoped to avoid.
Too many.
I don't even want to go there.
Okay, I have no report this evening. Do we have any public comment for any matter that is not on the agenda tonight? Hearing none, Bob?
Couple things. I was not able to go to the tree lighting, but I was able to drive past it on the way to returning a child to college. It looked really busy.
Yeah.
Haven Street was closed for the second year in a row, and I could just drive by and look down, and it looked like almost the Fall Street Fair kind of volume.
Wow.
So I haven't heard from the chamber. I don't know of any employees that went.
It looked like, I would say, a good 200 to 300 people at least were there.
I know they had a food tent down the road on Haven, which was meant to draw people, and apparently it did.
So there was a bit, I was there. I was actually working in the chamber booth.
Might have been more down.
So I was down there for about 2 hours.
Okay.
And it was, the place was jamming. I mean, it was chilly, but it was sunny, and there was a lot of kids and a lot of young families. And there was a really good-sized tent where there was a lot of food sampling going on, and, you know, hot chocolate and hot cider and all that kind of stuff. And there was a big crowd. There was a lot of people roaming around, so.
Okay. And likewise, the same day, North Reading had a similar thing. And I did want to just update for the board publicly. Some of you know this, probably most of you do. We've been in discussions with North Reading on allowing them to join the MWRA. We had another staff meeting today, so we're now to the point, just so you have a time frame. North Reading has had approval from town meeting in the fall to get initial design funding. They probably need to go back to their June town meeting next spring and get final design funding. And then sometime within the next year, they will probably ask town meeting to vote to join the MWRA with all the repercussions that go on with that. What staff and I talked about for the last week or so is a change in philosophy. We were going to have to do between $3 and $4 million of infrastructure work in Reading and have to send that through our town meeting and explain it and supervise it. And I finally thought that it's not worth that. Let North Reading take care of all the work. We can supervise it, but let them take it through their town meeting because it's just less complicated and much faster.
It's not like there's a markup.
Right, exactly.
I mean, you know,
no, that comes
so,
on the water. That's a different discussion.
Yeah. Not by us, though.
See,
it does.
Razor model,
yes,
give away the razor,
yeah.
Charge
exactly.
The blades. Yeah.
So, you know, there will be 3 or 4 streets impacted. There's water mains that need to be enlarged. As we go further along in the process, we'll get that out to the community. We're coordinating it with the gas company, our own water and sewer plans, paving plans, and so forth. So it's just like it's a Reading project, if you will, but it'll be done by North Reading.
Did we anticipate this when we dug up South Main, and we just have to now reinforce up to?
Yes, that one's okay.
Yep.
But there's some work we probably did 3 or 4 years ago we didn't anticipate.
Okay.
Because we just had no idea. I will describe their track as a fast one compared to how I know Reading went through the process. Although we were, again, kind of blazing the ground, so it won't be quite as difficult for North Reading. But like we did, they're abandoning both the Ipswich River, and in their case, they have another supplier from up north.
They've got some urgency.
Yeah.
They've
and
got some urgency
one of the benefits
that.
To us, there'll be a few, but one of the benefits to us will be if they join and if they wheel water through Reading as we plan, we will also have emergency access to their supply up north.
Okay.
as an alternative
triply
supply.
Redundant.
Right. So that would be, as it is, MWRA is giving us redundancy by having two connections into Reading, but this would be a non-MWRA source, which would be excellent.
I think it's their Andover source?
Yeah, it's up that
yeah.
way. Yeah. And they can't buy enough water for what they want. For those of you that know, they have a lot of undeveloped land that's marked for economic development.
Mm-hmm.
They just don't have the infrastructure, water and sewer to support it.
And they actually, I don't want to say they have a line at the door, but they have people,
yeah.
If they have the proper infrastructure for water, there's a lot of
yeah.
a lot of land to be developed there for them economically. So
yeah, they have campus-style opportunities for
right.
a larger, you know, a Keurig-like
sure.
company. So in addition to being a
if
good neighbor, yeah, exactly. So, you know, we also will get a small economic benefit. We'll have to put together an IMA. We'll have to go to you. It'll be a fairly legally intense process. I would expect to see that in the first quarter next year. The first one will just be intermunicipal agreement. The first one will just be to allow them to be in Reading doing test drilling and things like that, and then there'll be a more complicated one to actually finalize it when we get that far.
Are they the first town after we did to join NWRA?
That's a good question. I don't think so,
they
but in this area, absolutely.
They were trying to increase their sales.
I think they had a couple down south and maybe one out west. Small communities. They have the same problem we do, fixed costs and keep conserving water, the MWRA I'm speaking of.
Bob, at what point will the discussion commence in both towns regarding who will manage?
I think we plan to let them stand alone.
Oh,
and in the future, if that's a discussion, we'll have it. But
right.
We're planning to just leave them alone. There are other examples of this. And there's something called a wheeling charge. So you are allowed to charge
good.
A markup on the water because effectively it's wear and tear on your own system.
So
that wouldn't be there.
Charges us.
Well, we'll see. But we'll work all that out.
They're coming out of an MWRA built main, I think. So that may be different.
Yeah. But I just wanted to make sure I said that in public because we'll probably give an update at April town meeting if there's anything worth updating.
Right.
But this takes Reading's town meeting very much out of the mix, I think.
Oh, it does? Okay.
Yeah. And I think it just makes it a lot simpler for North Reading to go about its business.
Well, it's important to give them a comprehensive report then just so they don't
feel
like they've been bypassed.
Yeah.
Is there any downside to us for kind of doing this? I mean, risk
well,
mitigation.
I suppose there's things that could go wrong, but aside from that, no. I mean, we should be happy that the MWRA has more customers.
The only downside I could think is if you had a failure upstream, you'd want to wall that off while you continue to live on your two downstream sources.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want it to
cascade.
Right. Bob, do you think there are enough role models? You talked about the wheeling charge. Are there other examples?
There's not a lot of role models, but there's a couple. We'll probably think about that as guidelines. Bedford isn't one of them. I got a copy of their agreement this morning.
Is there any aid we can give to, probably the wrong way to say it, but is there any lessons learned that we can give them in terms of, as we went through this the first
time? We have.
Okay.
Yeah, we've been talking to them for about a year and a half, actually, and a lot of it was kind of battle scars and how you go through the process. Again, the process now is much more streamlined than we went through it. We really went through the ringer with some of the state agencies. We were in rooms where the state agencies are fighting with each other, and now they don't do that. But we were the first, so it really was a new discussion for a lot of folks in that room. We've talked a lot, and the chair and the vice chair of the Selectmen have met a couple times to just discuss it and kind of go through it.
And maybe this process brings the two towns closer together. They get used to working with one another. Maybe there's other things down the road that we could do together.
RMLD would love to.
Merger and acquisition.
I
was gonna say, we haven't even thought about what we can do.
I did mention the word takeover.
Did we already do a spinoff there?
Yeah, we did.
But seriously, on the RMLD front, may be a vehicle to use as a role model going forward for RMLD, where it's cooperation, you get the relationships, there may be some, they've got all the same buying economies that you have with water, right? All the fixed expenses. So.
Yeah, plus they get new customers.
It's harder now for a municipal to kind of take, get a new market.
It is.
Haven't the for-profit ones really made it tougher for
municipals you can't
to kind
start
of
up, yeah.
Even.
And it's contiguous. It's so much nicer, right?
Right.
Yeah, we have a good relationship with North Reading. Their new town administrator is probably taking them in a direction more similar to Reading, so we might have more to do together.
Right.
I'd say the same of the Board of Selectmen. Regionalization is not easy. A lot of it depends on the leadership, and leadership changes both in boards and managers. And you have to always recognize the fact that no two towns are exactly alike on any topic. So we're discussing other regionalization. Gene has successfully implemented a regional housing office with them. We're talking about animal control. We've talked about probably four other things. But
there's some private enterprise that's discussing things back and forth too between the towns. I think there's a kind of an openness to that discussion. And meeting with the vice chair and the chair over there, those were very cordial discussions, I thought.
Yeah.
That's really all I'll mention. And now, I know Sharon, I was going to talk about the procurement, but Sharon can do that.
Well, let's let Kevin go to liaison report if he so desires.
I actually have no liaison report to give.
You're in good company tonight. All right, well, I guess with that, we can turn it over to Sharon. We're gonna talk about the chief procurement officer designation.
Yes, you've got a blank form that looks like this in your packet. Did you call it to fill out?
Yeah, it's filled out.
Okay.
I already have it.
So essentially, the Inspector General's office had asked us to complete these forms, one of which is the appointment of the chief procurement officer, which our charter says is our town manager. But we haven't filed one of these before, so they asked us to get one on file. And now that we have a different town manager than we had, you know, for 26 years, they've probably had Peter on file. So this is just a formality where you would want to fill it in, and you obviously vote it, and then the chairman would sign the bottom. And in the area of number two, you can actually require certain things of the chief procurement officer, or you can check nothing, because he's probably going to designate out to somebody who's already certified in procurement. And this kind of is a good segue into some changes we need to make. Because of that investigation we were doing related to procurement, we didn't make any changes. But I want to say like a year and a half ago, they changed the procurement law so that it used to be that if you had something that was costing more than $5,000, you needed to get free bids, and then up to $25,000, and then $25,000 or more, you needed to go out to bid, whereas you could get quotes for anything under $25,000. They changed that to $10,000 for...
Which one, the five or the 25?
They changed both, the quotes to 10,000 and the bids for, to 35,000. And we kind of left ours alone internally because we were doing all that investigating and procurement, and we didn't want to make it look like we were changing things in the midst of it. So having completed this form, there's also the designation forms that Bob can complete once he's kind of certified, you know, by you as the chief procurement officer, to designate procurement responsibilities to different folks within the town, probably department heads, and then obviously we have a centralized procurement position. That position would most definitely get a designation from Bob. And then we report all that stuff back to the state. So that's basically all. It's just kind of a formality. Our charter does define him as the chief procurement officer. Just they need you to acknowledge it and sign.
Mm-hmm. Questions from the board? Bob?
In terms of folks that are actually certified for this, historically we've thought three is a good idea. Sometimes we've only had two, one in the schools and one in the town, and then a third one. Right now we only have two that I'm aware of. There's others. Joe had one, but it lapsed.
I had one.
You had one, but it lapsed, right?
Yeah.
So we only have two currently. Jane Kinsella is the one on the town side, but with this new position the town meeting approved, that'll be our third. I don't believe the town manager will probably go through that process. I could, but I'm not sure there's any real advantage to it.
So this is mostly, you know, you're the chief.
This is a formality, just telling the state what we already have done for 26 years and what the charter says we must do.
Right, but you're not going to be the one doing all that.
No, I won't change my behavior in the least.
When he's signing off on
requisitions,
we're proving to him that we've done the process, or who's not going to sign off.
We're certifying what the charter is making, is calling for us to do.
And the charter is the higher authority, make no mistake. But
right.
This is something the state has asked for, and it seems reasonable.
How often does this have to be reviewed as the town manager?
I'd say with a new...
Whenever there's a new town manager, you want to designate
sure.
or name them by name.
So we're good for like another 25 years.
Yeah. At the end of the night.
25 minutes.
But our controls internally are set up so that anything that hits that $25,000 threshold will go to Bob, and his job is to look, is the procurement done? Is the backup there that shows me they did the procurement properly? I mean, he only has to kind of know the basics to do that. He's not the one executing a bid or anything, and the certified procurement person should know how to do all that.
It's only on the town side.
No, it's actually both. And actually, we made a recent change that the superintendent thought was okay, which is Jane Kinsella is above everyone on the schools and the town, and then I'm after her. So there's good sets of eyes on everything the school does and the town does. It's just a helpful thing to have more sets of eyes.
And with all that's happened, I've been looking at it too, so both Jane and I are looking at some of the same things.
How many transactions a year?
Boy, last year was really busy. There was a lot of capital going on in these facilities.
Yeah.
All those different projects
with
different parts to them.
Schools and towns.
But you were doing that anyway, weren't you?
Yeah, we had.
Yeah, so I mean.
No, there's no change, as I said.
I'm just curious about the activity level.
Yeah, generally not as busy as it's been for the last 12 months.
It's good that you now be in
the world. DPW and facilities are the most active.
Mm-hmm.
They buy the most stuff.
And RMLD is going to continue to do what they do.
They're separate, so. I don't oversee or sign any of their things other than their general bill rules, which is, does include capital.
Anything that requires procurement is going to have multiple levels of approval going through the requisition process and BOD being the final.
Mm-hmm. All right, are we ready for a motion? We can have more discussion if necessary. Mr. Secretary.
Move the Board of Selectmen appoint the town manager as the chief procurement officer for the town of Reading.
Seconded.
Seconded.
Now further discussion. Any further discussion? All in favor? Opposed? The motion carries 5-0. I see our MAPC rep, is it Jennifer, do I remember your name?
You're Sharon.
Thank you very much for all the hard work that's gone in. We're eagerly awaiting your presentation.
Bob told me I had to sit at the big table.
Okay.
Great. Oh, that's great.
Awesome. Good, because I didn't print.
Well, Jennifer Erickson from MAPC is handing
you
out the report.
Nice to see you again.
I just wanted to make a few comments. As I think most of you are aware, this has been culmination of about a year and a half worth of work that we've been following with the help of MAPC. But I wanted to just back up for a minute to go back to something that we did, I guess it's better than 2 years ago, which was the EDSAT. And you might remember Professor Bluestone came and did some work for us and gave us a final report. And I brought sort of the crib notes on what that report said. And some of the highlights were investigate and streamline the permitting process. And as an additional work product with MAPC, that's something that we're working on, and we have a draft. So hopefully I'll be coming back to you shortly on that. Guides and checklists and all the things that we've kind of been talking about hand in hand with how do we advance economic development, because we found out, and we've always known, that the permitting process can almost be, you know, a real deterrent for applicants and for businesses, and so we want to make sure we're doing the very best we can with that. But the second thing on the list, and these were all the high ranked, was to craft a comprehensive economic development plan with a strong industrial commercial attraction policy, marketing strategy, and using input from stakeholders. So this didn't just all of a sudden happen. It was sort of taking that marching orders from the EDSAT and saying, okay, let's start implementing these things. So those are the two top. And then the third thing, it was identify and rezone appropriate properties to increase available sites for commercial and industrial development. So you'll see the four priority development areas that we're looking at. And rather than jump ahead and go to rezone, we really thought it was worth taking the time to have a lot of public outreach, a community engagement process that would feed into that and help us decide where do we want to go with rezoning. So this really fits well into the sort of the menu of options from the EDSAT, and it hits all of the high points. There are some other things about getting involved in parking and doing things with our website, which we're also working on. Parking, as you know, is something that we'll be coming back to you on probably in the next 6 months to have that conversation. But again, I wanted to kind of set the table for kind of why we did this and hopefully where it will lead us for future action steps.
Very good.
And with that, I'll turn it over to Jen Erickson from the Metropolitan Area Planning Council. See, I didn't use the acronym.
Thank
First,
you.
I would say it's been great to work with Jean and Bob on this project. MAPC has a long relationship with the town of Reading, and we're very excited about this opportunity to continue doing planning work with the town. So with that, the next 25 minutes, I'll give an overview of the process to develop this action plan, and then I believe we have a full hour.
You have more than that if you need it.
You have as much time as you need.
We're ahead of time.
This is really important.
So that will give us substantial time to walk through the action plan strategies,
please,
which is the last couple of slides in this presentation. So this presentation will go through the project goals, elements, and development process. I'll review some high-level findings from the project components, which included a retail office and residential market analysis, and development potential scenarios modeling. I'll also review the draft economic development vision for the town and a set of economic development strategies for a 7-year action plan period. And then we can talk about next steps, what needs to happen to implement the action plan. So MAPC is the regional planning agency for the Metropolitan Boston region. We have a number of divisions, including Land Use Division, that provides planning assistance to cities and towns. This action plan, as Jean mentioned, focuses on 4 priority development areas in town, and these 4 areas were developed through a regional process that Reading was a part of that involved 8 communities north of Boston. So your neighbors, including Wakefield and Burlington, were part of that mapping process. So that occurred from 2012 to 2014, so this planning process built on that. And Reading was the first community to jump on board and say, we want to actually develop an action plan to implement these priority areas that we've identified. So this is a graphic summarizing the elements that went into feeding this, fed into the development of this action plan. Public engagement, as Jean mentioned, the next slide will go over all the things we've done since August of last year to get public input into this development process. We have an economic development team that did a retail and office market analysis and also a residential market analysis. So we can have a picture of opportunity for Reading to capture and attract more retail and office development, as well as the residential that's needed to support that growing customer base. We also worked with our data services team to do some modeling of development potential. If redevelopment were to occur in some prime parcels in these 4 priority development areas, what could be possible? We also did some visual preference surveying of residents to understand people's preferences in terms of density and design and uses. And we also worked with a team of staff that had experience with doing graphic visualizations to do some renderings of what redevelopment could look like. And that's the conceptual urban design work we did in 1PDA. So this is an overview of our outreach and engagement to date. We had a project advisory committee that we formed that included members of the former Economic Development Committee. It also included Kevin and as well as John and also town staff. And we met 4 times over the course of the project. The town did a lot of press publicity along with our communication staff. We released press releases for every public meeting. At one point we did a mailing to abutters in some of the PDAs. And we also got television coverage for every public meeting, so it was televised. So we held 3 large public meetings. Each public meeting was very well attended by between 50 and 60 residents, business owners, and people who work or have some other affiliation with the town of Reading. April 1st, 2015 was our first public meeting. June 3rd was our second public meeting, and October 7th was our last public meeting. So the format of these meetings were very interactive. We did a mix of visual preference polling, small group discussion stations, and also we ended in an open house format where people could walk around the room, have a chance to talk with MAPC and town staff about all of the strategies we've identified. And the public comment period, the draft that you have in front of you, was posted for 2 weeks. So today is the official end of the public comment period, so people have until the end of the day today to send me comments by email or by phone.
Have you received any today?
Yes, I have. I received 3. I received 1 on Thursday, and 3 more today. So I can actually send around a draft. Actually, why don't I do that now? I have a summary of all the public feedback we received today, so you can take a look.
And total 2-week span?
1 copy to pass around. Yep, so there's a 2-week time frame for people to email comments or send us, leave me a phone message with their feedback. So this is an overview of all of the planning work the town has already done in the last 10 years that this plan seeks to build upon. We weren't trying to reinvent the wheel, we were really trying to listen and build on work that's been done. I will say that the town of Reading has been very busy. You know, you did do a master plan about 10 years ago, and I know there's some conversation about sort of exploring doing that again. But since then, there's been a downtown market assessment and business district composition analysis in 2007. There was a Main Street corridor study that also involved Wakefield and Melrose. There was a housing production plan that was done. There was the EDSAT, which was done with Northeastern in 2014, and a bicycle network and pedestrian priority plan, which was also done with MAPC assistance, along with the Main Street corridor study. There was also a downtown cultural district exploratory study. as well as some economic development related work. A Reading is Ready for Your Business brochure and a guide, the Guide to Doing Business in Reading, which is being updated with MAPC assistance this year. And then, of course, the Purdy Mapping Project, which this project directly builds upon. So project context, the other thing I want to highlight is that Reading has already adopted many policies, guidelines, and standards that support a vibrant mix of land uses and a quality public realm. All of these things create the environment in which, you know, economic development can really happen. So I want to call out these five things that the town has adopted that are significant, notable. The Downtown Smart Growth District, the Gateway Smart Growth District, the South Main Street Design Best Practices, the zoning bylaw changes, and the adoption of a complete streets policy, which is also done with MAPC assistance. So this is a map of the four areas that we're focusing on. You'll hear me reference, unfortunately, an acronym, PDA, which stands for Priority Development Area. So PDA number one is the proposed 40R expansion area, which is concentrated in the downtown right around the commuter rail station. So I believe I have a pointer. Here. So PDA number two is South Main Street, and this is this corridor. And then PDA number three is New Crossing Road Redevelopment District, as well as adjacent Ass Street parcels. I will note that in the mapping process, we identified only the New Crossing Road district parcels, but we added the Ass Street parcels because we realized it would be very important to promote redevelopment in that area to ensure a good transition of uses between South Main Street and PDA number three. PDA number four is One General Way. Is there anything you'd like to add before I move on?
I think this map is probably the most telling because when you see it on the map, at least for me, you realize that these areas don't really, you don't think of them as connected. But there's no reason why they couldn't be, and there's no reason why the connection to downtown couldn't be emphasized through some pretty easy changes. One of the things that happened over the summer is that one project on Ash Street, Dr. Ravens, I don't know if you guys, okay, so he did a bunch of work on his property. This was the one that when the house, he bought the house next door and they demolished it, all the money fell out.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so when he started renovating and working on the site and expanding the parking where the house with all the money that fell out, he went through the site plan review, and as part of that, at the planning board stage, we realized that this was a real opportunity to improve an important corner of the town. And so he had a really nice plan, and as part of that, he put in sidewalks and put in green space. And when you look at before and afters, it's really significant. It is.
Yeah.
And he cleaned
up
all around the railroad tracks. And then you realize, wait a minute, you can walk from Dr. Ravens to the downtown very easily.
Yeah.
And it's a natural connection. We got a little work to do, but you can start to see it. And at that point, we said, wait a minute now, maybe we should be thinking from Dr. Ravens all the way down on what the potential is for this whole area. And that's why we kind of expanded it as we started. We thought, yeah, let's look at it that way and see where we might be able to go with this.
It is kind of amazing when you stop to think, without it being grandiose, I mean, what he did there, I mean, you know, he expanded, it became, you know, the Ravens family, you know, dental office, and you don't have to be a big box to do something really special and really have a very nice business.
Changed the whole fabric of Ash Street.
And that is literally steps away from one of these other PDAs. I mean, literally steps.
I mean, there are definitely infrastructure improvements that can be made, which, you know, we'll talk about when we get to strategies that can sort of strengthen walkability and accessibility between the different areas. But all these areas are within that 10-15 minutes from the commuter rail. So it's pretty amazing that you have that access here, and you can definitely market that and promote that in terms of redevelopment potential.
So the 1A, that is that what includes the Walgreens?
Yes.
There's a lot of residential around there, too.
Holton's, or not Holton's?
1A
does not.
Is, this is Haven Street, so it's from Haven Street down to Main and High and Washington.
Yeah, you have to get across the street.
Yeah, the Walgreens is a little bit further out.
Yeah.
Right, there is a lot of, right, this is.
There's another Walgreens, that you're probably thinking of the Walgreens on High, on Haven Street.
Oh, no, I was thinking of the one on.
You're thinking of Walgreens on Main Street?
The one that's empty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's not in that framework of that, because everything you're looking at there is south of Haven Street.
And west of Main Street.
1A is mostly residential, correct?
A lot of it is.
Yeah, a lot of it is residential behind the businesses on.
The American Legion's back in there, and, you know, King's Auto, and, but then behind them is a lot of residential.
It's okay. So we're on the next slide. So now we get into the market analysis findings, and this is very high level, but if you go into the appendices document, it's the full retail and residential and office market analysis. Those documents are quite long, so we did not include them in the body of the report, and we just focused on highlighting the key findings in the body of the report. So our economic development staff spoke with brokers, businesses. They conducted a series of interviews. They also used Esri business data to do this market analysis. So their key findings, I can highlight a little bit about what they heard, which is that, you know, there's not a lot of retail turnover. Retailers reported that they were doing good business. Retailers thought residential would be good for business. Brokers felt that the single family market is strong in Reading, and there is demand for well-located housing that would also support the local business community. In terms of findings, retail potential, these are sort of the growth areas for Reading. Food stores, health stores, used merchandise, and restaurants. Office potential, there is potential to attract more small professional offices in the downtown. However, when we look at the region in which Reading operates, there is limited opportunity to capture major office development. And again, consistent with the EDSAT findings, it's important to craft an economic development attraction and marketing strategy. So again, in terms of summary of key findings, small professional offices in the downtown South Main Street area, a large office tenant could be supported by the regional market, but there is strong competition by areas like Burlington. Build-to-suit would be the greatest potential in Reading.
When you say build-to-suit, that means you find a tenant, or you have an operator that basically wants to come here, and then you just build it around.
Yes.
So. You have the client, then you just have to make the product, as opposed to you have the product, then find the client.
Yes. The residential market analysis. So Reading has strong community assets when we look at it compared to other communities in the North Suburban region. Residents in Reading have, you know, higher education levels, higher income levels. There's a good school system here. The housing market is strong, and that prices are at all-time highs. In terms of what we heard from brokers and through the interviews, brokers felt that the single family housing market was strong in Reading, but also that there was a demand for well-located multifamily housing. They did note that new units are selling for a premium, and that some are slow to sell in some areas, such as in Reading Woods. We have estimates of housing needs townwide for the town that are informed in part by our MAPC's work to develop housing projections. So our projections indicate that there could be the potential for 950 additional potential housing units over the next 10 to 15 years in Reading. And there is strong demand for housing in or near the downtown, which is appealing to both households preferring, which can include both seniors and younger households that prefer a walkable environment.
Jennifer, is that 950, is that including some things that right now are trying to get on the books and get going?
In the pipeline?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So the other thing we've been trying to elevate and understand from the residents is their preferences around design and uses. So at our first public meeting, we did a polling exercise asking people for some of that feedback. And I will just highlight that some of the uses, you know, we showed images, exemplary different types of uses, and also different types of design. And sometimes it can be very difficult to separate out, you know, are people reacting to how something looks versus, you know, what types of uses it would actually be in the building. So it's a little bit of both, so we tried to sort of elicit both of those types of feedback. So, high-level summary of findings. for PDA number one, people like the idea of attracting more mixed-use development in that area. PDA number two, people would like and be supportive of commercial on the first floor, and they like the inclusion of retail. So mixed use in the northern segment of South Main Street, that's closer to Haven. They like, and so for PDA number three, we showed some examples of mixed use and commercial. People liked some examples that included some office, as well as some more creative spaces. And people really emphasized the need to prioritize commercial in that area. And in terms of PDA three, because of how it's currently set up and the infrastructure improvement opportunities, it was difficult for people to picture anything other than what's already there, which we often find when we do visual preference sometimes. It's hard to picture, you know, what the future can look like, which is why we do some of the visual renderings to help visualize development potential. So in the action plan, we drafted a vision statement for the town. So it's a couple sentences long, so it's going to be the next two slides, but this is part one of the vision statement. And some of this, I will note, is actually modified from your 2005 master plan. We use that as a starting point. The economic development vision does articulate it. So Reading is a vibrant suburban town where businesses can thrive and different generations can meet, connect, and build community. Reading's assets include quality schools, a walkable downtown, bike lanes, transit options, including commuter rail service, and access to major roads, and a lively downtown with retail shops and restaurants. Part two. Reading is committed to strengthening existing businesses, attracting new ones, and expanding the resident base that's needed to support a growing local economy. Reading and community partners will work together to implement this action plan of policy changes, infrastructure investments, and programmatic activities that aim to place the town on firm financial footing for generations and maximize quality of life for current and future generations of people who choose Reading as a place to live, work, study, and play. So we asked people at the last public meeting in October to give us some feedback on this vision statement. So there are some changes in here that reflect some of that feedback that we received. And if you have any comments, changes, additions, you know? So there are a series of strategies that we've identified. And this is where we can sort of go a little slower. I think we're doing
Don't worry about it.
This is really important.
We have till midnight.
We have till midnight.
For comments.
11:59:59, actually.
So if you actually open up the draft action plan, if you jump to page 47, this is where the strategies action plan matrix starts. And you know, we'll end after we talk about the strategies. We'll come to a place where we can talk about the investment of funding and staffing that's needed to implement this action plan.
Second line.
Because that's something, you know, that's come up both in the public comments I've received via email from people while this draft has been out for comment. And it's also something I know is on Gene's mind, and we've talked about that. And I know that the town and all of you have actively been thinking about that. So we'll end there. So this action plan matrix in the draft categorizes the actions and strategies by whether it's a near-term, mid-term, or long-term priority to implement. And what that basically means is, you know, during what year will the town start working on that action item? Many of these action items obviously will continue on for future years, but each strategy listed here is categorized by when we recommend starting that work. So there are six different categories of action. So we can walk through each one. So strategy one is adopting local policies and practices that will facilitate compact development and mixed use and the transit accessible priority development areas. So strategy one is expanding the downtown smart growth district to PDAs 1A and 1B to continue fostering mixed use development in the commuter rail station area.
So is that an expansion of what I understand to be 40 hours? Is that what that is?
Yes. So this, the area that we included is actually what the town originally had proposed as a 40 yard area.
But it is, but that isn't how it ended.
Right.
Okay, I mean, that's how it started, but that's not how it ended. So whose purview is that to work on that type of, you know, rezone? Is that up to the Board of Selectmen? Is that the town meeting? Is that, you know, something being fostered by the Board of Selectmen to the town meeting? How does that, tell us about that process.
I'd be happy to jump in. Any type of zoning change, which is what we're talking about, an overlay district, expanding that overlay district under the zoning bylaw, that requires an action, public hearings, public notice, all through the Community Planning Development Commission, the Planning Board. So just like we've done with all of the other zoning work, it has to be vetted through CPDC.
Does it end up at town meeting?
And then it ends up at town meeting.
If you close a warrant article.
The only way we can do it is through a two-thirds affirmative vote of town meeting. But to get it there, it has to come via CPDC.
The unspoken need here is, takes people to do this work. Now, looking at your current and future staff, when you get up to full strength from where you are, is that going to do it? Or are you going to need additional resources to carry out the precepts here?
Bob and I had this conversation today.
Discussion about 4 hours ago. There's not enough staffing.
Well, we could do like similarly what we do with the whole zoning.
Well, I want to hear what Gene has to say.
It depends. If you want to go in this direction, we clearly need more staff. We do have a community development director now. She's been here for 2 days. I didn't bring her here tonight because I didn't want to scare her.
I'm afraid she's not rock solid.
Every day she comes back, I do like this.
It's not true.
But her name is Julie Mercier, and she's great. And she and I have already had a lot of conversations about, you know, what can we get going on? She's looking, writing a grant. You know, she's great. But really, to do this the right way, we need two things. We need capacity, and we need resources. And so the real question is, where do the resources come from? Do they come from, you know, we'll get to that at the end, some models that are public-private partnerships. Should there be a 501c3? Should there be, there are any number of different models that different cities and towns use.
I'm a dedicated person. We talked about this a little bit when we did in the
yes.
EDC that we would come back with
yep.
different ideas.
Yep, you could do staffing, you could do, it should be a partnership. Regardless of if the staffing never changed, there should be, in my opinion, there should be a partnership effort. Staff cannot go and do this. Even if I had a team of planners, I couldn't execute this without buy-in from the business community.
Consensus.
Yeah.
Well,
no
you
way.
Need to have people step forward for development. I mean, that
too,
you know, you can zone all you want.
Exactly.
You know, if there's not willing partners to step in and take advantage of
this. Just to complete the thought here, should we be thinking of adding at least one dedicated staff person as we move into the FY17 budget season?
Well, I had that in my budget, but I don't think we, I'll
the
let Bob
manager
speak.
The town manager won't have it in his, though.
Okay.
What's new?
Exactly.
No, I mean, just, I mean, the whole, we talked, it's talked about just there in 1A and 1B, but does it make sense? Because zoning is the rules. Zoning basically puts out to the world what we want. And as we know, when we put out what we want, when we can control what we want, it's a better product than what the world comes and says, this is what we want.
Well, we've seen that.
Right.
Sure.
So does it, you know, we're talking about 1A and 1B, but does it make sense to just look at every comprehensive zoning change we're going to need for priority development 2, 3, and 4 so that we get the zoning done all at once, right? So now that puts out, this is how we want to see this developed, as opposed to doing piecemeal, because I remember what happened with, what was Addison Wesley? A developer came in and said they want to do this.
That's
we
right.
went, we bent salt backwards, we changed the zoning, he walked away, mm-hmm. right? So,
right.
As it, you know, that is not a town-friendly process. What a town-friendly process would be, would for us to say, okay, this is how we envision it. This is what we would like, and then get the zoning done for all the areas.
But you don't do it in a vacuum. You bring
no, but you do the same exactly how the same process. It's a very similar process to what Gene, you know, what you did when you did the whole zoning, the comprehensive zoning. You bought in a lot of public. First of all, we had a consultant that we paid, you know,
yeah.
that got some staff help to do, and now those were tons of public hearings. And people brought in. Same process, I'm not saying doing it in a vacuum, but get the zoning done all at once.
Your point is, do it in a holistic fashion so that all of the four PDAs, or however many ultimately are done in concert with each other so that the community can see them all.
Right. And it's connected.
And it's connected and it's consistent. I think that's the, that might be the end state. Dan's talking about the process to get there, right, in terms of being holistic and having enough, because the community's got to wrap their head around this. It's going to take a while to do that.
Well, I mean, the community's already invested.
Well, I mean, lots of what Jennifer has done with, you know, with her group is, there's been a lot of public engagement.
Not just direct. Public engagement, it's engagement with the people who will be building this stuff.
Yeah.
Right. We'll work for them. If you really want to work with them, you got to bring them in.
Yeah. Yeah. If you build it, they may not come, right? So you really.
If you build them with, if you zone it without their input, they may not come. So we learned that the hard way on the landfill.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
So, Barry, I think you're really onto something, because we're now living, I mean, we're directly experiencing the lack of a holistic view. I mean, these areas, theoretically, in question, the ones we're talking about, would already be properly zoned had we moved forward in a holistic way. And we chose not to. And the product of that, you know, sits across the tracks. I'm kind of, the only thing that scares me about trying to get it all done at once is it rise, either all the boats rise or all the boats sink.
It sinks or
you know,
falls
I mean.
Wouldn't it make sense to like take one general way as a starting point? That seems to be the low hanging fruit, yes, no?
I mean, yeah. So, I feel strongly that that it would be really a great thing to get at least the 1B piece
1B?
Into the 40R district.
Yeah.
At least at a minimum to get that done.
So,
that's the due set.
1B, that yeah. Yeah, that was left out mysteriously before.
But what's the sense of doing that piece if that's already going to be developed?
It might make sense to do it anyway, just in case.
I'd like to see
saying.
Us do across the street.
Right. Across the street.
Which is the...
Oh, that area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which
yeah.
is 1A.
Is that included in 1A? Of the map? You say
it might be useful to have a little map on every page because we're all kind of
no, it isn't.
Well, it'd be hard to see, but you can see it in the action. There is a map.
There are reasons. Yeah,
the automotive uses on
that. Why were not the high street properties included?
Yeah, that's very interesting that they're excluded.
They're already in it.
Oh, they are. Okay.
So you can actually realize.
Yeah.
The parts
are in.
Okay, so that side of the tracks is in. This side of the tracks is out.
Well, it just makes it a better development.
Yeah.
Yeah, that should be shown here just for completeness.
Starting on page 28, there are sort of info sheets on each of the PDAs where you can see, and it's still a little bit small.
So while we're checking that, Gene, in 1A.
I'm just going to pull up the smart growth map so you can see what's there
yeah.
now.
Sorry,
go ahead.
Dotted line.
No, you're going to answer my question, I think, because I'm wondering, you know, what's in and what isn't, and this is going to answer that question. Makes me wonder, I mean, does it run all the way to Woburn Street? I think not,
no,
but
it doesn't. It runs one block behind or one property line.
It's sort of, yeah.
One property line, because there's not a street in between. So, for example, the back of the post office is, but the Woburn Street property that adjoins it is not.
I believe the bank parking lot is.
Yeah.
But the funeral home
Woburn
is not.
Front is not.
Right.
And that was another discussion that the board had at the time.
Yeah, I know. I remember.
These maps are the greatest thing ever.
Yep.
So that needs
a thing,
yeah. The blue thing.
Yeah, these are.
You gotta look at it how it's falling down.
So the downtown smart growth district starts here.
Oh.
It crosses over Main Street.
But does it run on Haven? Is that it must cross over behind Haven or north of Haven.
There it is.
This is it.
Okay.
It complements, yeah.
Yeah, don't go, yeah.
Yeah, that's really helpful to have, I think, on your general map, Jen, because a lot of those areas have yet to see redevelopment, and it's really a generic area we're talking about.
It's the IS map, that's how we're built today.
Okay, so I'll put a note to insert a zoom-in map of the current 40R.
So it looks like 40R runs to Sanborn Street, Woburn, and the corner of Woburn and Sanborn, and then makes a left.
That's synonymous to 40R, DSGD.
This is Woburn Street here.
Yep.
And it jogs, I think this is the CVS parking lot.
I think that's the bank parking lot right there.
Yeah.
It jogs in the back.
Or the post office.
Yep.
Yeah, I think you're one street off, John.
Yeah, it doesn't include Sanborn.
So on where 16 is that High Street?
Well.
No.
Yeah.
So are you saying that the post office is not in the 40R?
Post office is, yeah.
So that's Sanborn Street.
That red line is right in the middle of the CVS parking lot.
Yeah, it starts to jog in the back, and it only limits.
Oh, it's a residential.
It's like.
So the bank parking lot is in?
Yes.
Okay.
This isn't really that clear to be able to show.
If you click on each one, though, it gets clear if you want to.
And what is that, a zoning variance for residential? Business use of a residential property?
Yeah, exactly, it's grandfathered as business.
Very good. There we go.
And I think down Woburn, you have all houses.
Yeah, you do.
Stay in the quadrant.
Starting with 36.
Well, if you get, just gets a little clearer when you get into each.
Downtown Smart Growth, okay, here's the, little bit of it here. So this is where it starts to do that jogging. This blue line. So Woburn Street is here. Here's Linden, Bancroft, Shute, and Sanborn. So it catches just this side of Sanborn. And then it goes behind, there's a white medical building, whatever, here on the corner. So it goes behind it, not including that, it cuts that out. And then it jogs in the back here, and jogs and jogs.
So it's very interesting, there are three residential properties right there that really box off that district in a huge way.
Yep.
On pages 43 and 44 of the draft, there's a table summarizing the zoning currently applicable to the parcels in each of the four priority development areas. So that's just a quick glance table. We did insert a map, an excerpt of your zoning map, but we could do that.
That map would really be helpful.
Yep.
You know, if you kind of did red lines and yellow lines, where they're adjacent like that.
So where does that 40R stop on the other side of the tracks, right in the middle of Washington Street?
I don't think so.
It does go across, right?
No, that doesn't. It was the proposal. It doesn't look like what was the final.
No, it doesn't get all the way down to Washington Street at all.
Well, Washington takes that right, runs parallel with the tracks, right?
You can't make more than one grid.
It goes.
Where we're talking about
right
the
now
what's going on the corner.
See, that appears to go across the train tracks. But
right.
It doesn't.
Right. But I don't think, that's what.
Does not.
That's what I was getting at. It doesn't, right?
No. I think that's meaning to suggest that it goes to the train tracks.
Okay.
Well, we know it doesn't go across.
We definitely know it doesn't go across.
Yeah, I think, Jen, that would really be helpful to yellow line along with the red lines, especially up there.
Sure.
And I think that's really the only place that we've got that smart growth district, right?
Yep. For downtown.
Yeah.
All right,
I'll
put that down. So if we come back to the table 8 in the draft, page 47, did I hear a comment from Barry in terms of, you know, we have, you know, 1A is the focus on zoning for PDAs 1A and 1B, whereas 1B focuses on zoning for PDAs 2, 3, and 4. We put that as midterm. So near term is, you know, in the next 2 years. Midterm is going 3 to 4 years out. So is your comment that you would recommend?
Well, I just think it's from a, just from a strategic purpose of, you know, kind of put out, and also just from a bandwidth. I mean, if we're gonna, you know, if we're gonna spend time and energy doing zoning,
do it once.
Let's just do it once.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the other question you have is each one of these, I would assume, would have a different, different style component to it, i.e., a different type of developer that would be looking in, into it. You may have one developer that's ready to go now on 2, 3, and 4, and not on my A1B. You know, I think sometimes speed of getting it done in that regard would be interesting input from the, that community that's going to be looking at this and saying, yeah, that, if you did that, that's something that would be very interesting to grow. But, you know, you don't want to have somebody waiting on the wings because, no, actually, I fit better into 2, 3, and 4. That's more my suit. And it would be another component that we want to make sure.
Oh, yeah, 1A and B is a different, that's a different animal.
It's going to be two different things.
So to that point, Jennifer, I know that you, a lot of your research, I mean, having followed you now for over a year, is tied to, it tells us that certain things would be desirable, certain things are necessary, there's pent-up demand for certain kinds of development. I mean, those are all things that I've heard you talk about. So the question becomes, kind of to Dan's point is, do you have a way to help us access who those potential developers might be so that we can actually have an open discussion with them?
That's a really good question. MAPC is actually doing a series of developer roundtables.
Okay.
They've been sort of very focused conversations really for MAPC to listen to and build relationships with the developers in the region who are interested in TOD.
Right.
So we're having these conversations to sort of listen and understand, but our hope is to eventually link them up to what we know about the development priorities in our region. So we have done about 2 developer roundtables so far. Our housing staff are actually leading some of that work along with our transportation staff. So I can circle back with you, but yes, there may be a way for us to sort of
that would be really be helpful to us.
Have a facilitative role in bridging some of those conversations. So, you know, the other piece of that, which is, you know, one of the other strategies we'll get into is around the marketing and what the town can do to very visibly promote these opportunities. And that can be as easy as creating a series of web pages where you lift some of the key findings from your market analysis and promote them there.
Yep.
So, you know, that's something easy that the town can do with a little bit of help from whoever manages your website and, you know, some good language written by some of the planning community development staff.
Well, back to the website again, huh?
I guess you've talked about the website. So, yes, good point. So I'll put a note here.
You're turning a lot of rocks over, Jennifer.
You're not alone among communities that you know, are interested in having more direct, more communication with developers and how to market their development sites. So. And the other strategy, 1C, is pertaining to parking. So MAPC, we do have a transportation team that has done many parking studies with communities. And, you know, we have some parking best practices that we would love to discuss with the town. So when the time is right, we would love to assist the town with evaluating parking requirements and working with you to implement some changes that are consistent with parking best practices.
Might that include charging for parking?
Yes.
That can have positive and negative impacts.
Yes, it includes things like, you know, wayfinding signage, exploring tiered parking minimums and maximums based on uses.
Any success with smart parking, where you have basically an app on your phone that tells you the next opening is? You have limited inventory.
I know that there is a team of municipalities that's working with our transportation staff on a right-sized parking calculator.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know when that project wraps up, but I can find out more. But yes, we can have a separate parking conversation. And
all right, very good.
Just to go back to that John had, I could imagine it wouldn't just be an introduction, but it could be a whole idea generation session that comes out of that. It's a little bit of a chicken and an egg problem here where we've got a resource, we've got our own ideas, we've got people that do development for a living, and the outcome of that might be just more idea generation, not necessarily a path forward, but it still benefits both parties, because this could take a long time to yield.
Mm-hmm.
So I think one of
should I call you Kojak?
Yeah. One of the big benefits, frankly, could simply be in the first rounds is idea generation for both parties, because we need to get smarter on how this is going to play out. And there are folks out there that have a lot more experience than we do, and I'd love to get into a round table with them just to pick their brains and see what's going on.
And I will acknowledge that the town did do a parking study, right, back in 2009?
Yes.
And, you know, we would pick up from that. You know, there's been a lot of innovative thinking since, you know, in the last several years around parking.
Yeah,
so
I'm going to get on parking back to the
developer
thought.
Okay, yep.
Bob had a thought a moment ago, which, you know, imagine in a world where the PDAs, I think 3 and 4, had a way to get across the railroad tracks other than going through one of the crossways. Imagine there was a bridge of some sort. You could somehow link those and get some synergy between the two of those. How do you do that? How hard is it to do that? But there's areas where that's been done. That's the kind of...
you build it first and then you notice to the MBTA that you've done it.
I say
you can't ask for permission.
They own the airspace?
Yeah. All right. So are you ready to move on to the next set of strategies? Our next strategy? So strategy 2 is around enhancing walkability and connectivity within and between the community development areas. So some of the comments we got from the during the public comment period were pertaining to increasing walkability around PDA number 3. I know that RMLD has flagged that as something that they hope will improve in terms of access from PDA 3 to PDA 2. So these two strategies are, one, prioritizing infrastructure investments that will create a safe and welcoming pedestrian environment between the PDAs and between the PDAs and the commuter rail station. So the town has adopted a complete streets policy. So to implement that policy, the next step would be to sort of phase and prioritize infrastructure investments to improve the quality of sidewalks and walkability and wayfinding. 2B, prioritize improving connections around PDA 3 specifically and the Ash Street parcels to enhance the area's accessibility from PDA 2 and walkability to the commuter rail station. Any comments on this before we move on to the next set of strategies? So strategy 3 is around branding and marketing. So brand and market priority development areas to attract interest from developers, commercial establishments, and potential customers. So here's where we mention a couple of different ways of beginning to do that. So one would be convening a working group of stakeholders in and around downtown Reading that can develop a brand identity for priority development areas in Reading. 3B, establishing an online presence to market and promote development opportunities. And 3C, consolidating economic development resources in a new section of the website.
This is another area where I think you gotta have an owner. Somebody's got, I know we have a website, I don't mean to suggest anything, take away from what we're doing, but is this whole brand identity and promotion and what's the messaging and what's the, for the concepts to kind of get conversations going. This is your outreach to the developer community, one of them. The working group might be one, but this is the outreach would be a way that you do it without necessarily personal contact, at least initially.
Isn't this a discussion about rebranding and reestablishing an appropriate economic development group? I mean, we actually said as we closed down one that it was a temporary step, as we heard the rest of these findings, to recreate. But then it comes back to, you know, whether or not, yeah, I actually think you probably need a staff person to help drive that bus with a economic development, a reconstituted economic, I don't know that you need one, but it seems like you would.
I think it's clear we do.
A lot of roads are pointing to, you know, How do you develop the resources and pay for them?
Well, you might remember when, I keep going back to Barry Bluestone, but the one takeaway that I got when he was here was, who's selling Reading?
Well,
yeah,
that's a fair
exactly
question.
The point. You got a great product, but not many people know about it. It's the message, it's the medium, it's how do you deliver that in a way that's compelling to people.
And keep it current.
Right. That's the hardest thing to do is to keep it current, keep it fresh, right? And it may not be a staff person, but maybe consultants that come in periodically or have a contract that once a quarter or once a month come in and refresh what's there.
Somebody's got to be quarterbacking this thing all the time.
Yeah, I think it's got to be a staff person.
I mean, that's what I think. I don't know that that's the right answer, but it just, as I think about it from a
from the launch of a marketing strategy, having done that in business many times, somebody had to be on the point. And then you build in around it and go forward.
Your other strategies are about creating the supply and making sure the supply of the product, the positioning, the properties, the zoning, that's all properly done. This is about driving demand. And that's what gets, if you create the demand, the supply will tend to take care of itself a little bit better. Right. Creating the supply without the demand gets kind of boring. This is where I think it starts. It's getting eyeballs to come in and take a look at all the assets the town has, all the advantages the town has.
The question is, where does that central person that's sort of convening everyone live? Does that person live within the municipal staff structure? Do they live within a newly formed nonprofit? Do they live with, you know, the chamber? Do they live within a new iteration of existing groups? So, there's the New Reading North Reading Chamber, there's Shop the Block.
That is the magic question. Where does it live?
Yeah. Right. So it's hard to get away from that. There does need to be some investment in someone's staff time. But the question is, where does it live?
That's
and who's willing
person.
To provide that overhead for that person?
We could have a staff person who's dedicated to this, and their first order of business is to come back to the manager and the board with, here's how we do it. And they've gone and examined everything, and they put together a plan that does it. But it can't be you doing it a few hours a week, and it can't be existing groups, because they all have their own different kinds of things. I think that's we have somebody, and their first order is a recommendation for a battle plan.
The first order is get somebody who's done this before, has got a success story and a track record. The second is you got to build a consensus and a public-private partnership with the current stakeholders in town, because they're both beneficiaries and impacted parties.
Well, they're also potentially competitors. So it's not necessary. I mean, we're talking about bringing in new businesses to town.
True.
So, which will be a good overall thing for the town of Reading, but that could impact on existing businesses. So it has to be a comprehensive.
Usually, though, it's helpful. Usually, it's synergistic.
Yeah,
it seems like the findings that Jennifer and her team put together said that it's not so much to worry about competitors. If you build the district, everybody kind of all boats rise.
Right.
Exactly. I mean, I seem to remember some in one of the presentations. If you've got 5 restaurants that are clustered, they all tend
they all
to
do better.
Much better than having one that's isolated.
It's the Arlington one.
Yeah. Yeah. We have a Stop and Shop and a Market Basket that are 4 feet from each other, and they're both packed, so it can work.
The other thing is, it's not just about the attracting of the businesses, it's also listening for what the current businesses need. So, there is some value in having a person who's available to be that person that's listening about what they're, the challenges they're facing, and trying to troubleshoot and, reduce barriers.
Yeah, I think what, John, what you said, this isn't something that we should be looking to reinvent the wheel here. Someone's already done it for us.
Somebody's done this and done it successfully. We could be the 10th success story.
Right, and build on their success. Yeah.
And there's a template here. It's not like, all the work that Jennifer and her team have done have created a template. You need somebody that can execute against it that's got experience.
And I'm not sure if it was Jennifer or Gene, but it was you that sort of did the compilation of all the different cities and towns of their, what they've done.
Yeah.
I think there was 15 different towns, and there was 15 different models. I looked at that. There weren't two things that were really
the same. No, we got a cherry pick. Right? Let's borrow from those that have gone before us. There's a bunch of success stories in our peers. Let's go cherry pick for the best ideas.
So that summary is on page 52 and 53. So that work was done for the Planning Commission, and a high-level summary of some of those different models that are in place in those peer communities is summarized here. So the question is, do we want to continue talking about this, or would we like to sort of finish going through the strategies and come back to the staff and implementation?
Finish.
Okay.
We could torture you for hours if you stand
there. We've got pages up there for days.
Yeah, let's get through the strategies.
So there are 3 more strategies under this one pertaining to branding and marketing. So holding networking events for existing and prospective downtown Reading business owners. These events help strengthen relationships, and it's a great way for prospective business owners to learn about what it's like to operate a business in downtown. Maintaining a database of prospective retail and office tenants. So once you have that database, you can find ways to maintain communication with them. You can listen for and document interests and needs of prospective tenants. And this is a way to really listen for what some of that built-to-suit interest might be. 3F, implement a phased approach to market and redevelopment. So, you know, we do believe it's important to sort of phase it and concentrate on PDA 1, where you already have that concentration of activity and vibrancy and diversity in the businesses. And focus also on the northern segment of the South Main Street corridor. And then next would be promoting PDA number 3 and PDA number 4, which are the larger, more complex opportunities. Any questions on these before we move on? So strategy 4, which I touched on a couple minutes ago, is supporting existing local businesses. So one strategy, working with existing local business groups to plan activities and events that will help support the local business community. There are a lot of things that are already happening ad hoc with some of the groups in town, like the Reading Fall Street Fair and Shop the Block holiday shopping event. Adding additional events and coordinating on business promotions would also help support and promote downtown Reading. 4B, connecting local business owners with programs that can help them strengthen and expand their businesses. So continuing to take advantage of state programs like the Massachusetts Downtown Initiative, which the town has utilized to bring in consultants that have helped businesses. Partnering with community partners to explore opportunities for lower cost services that can help them scale up their business operations. I highlight this because RMLD has been an active participant in our planning process. And you know, they have some ideas for services that they could potentially offer that would be a cost saving to businesses. And number 4C, identify a team of individuals in the town who can champion economic development and serve as the liaison.
That's like our supporting the EDC model.
Yep.
So the next strategy, promoting public-private partnerships and collaboration to maximize redevelopment potential. These actions under this strategy pertain to working with not only local but also regional entities and groups that have access to businesses, developers, and investors to market redevelopment potential. And 5C calls out the opportunity to actually promote parcel consolidation. So some of the development potential in PDA 3 can be unlocked if there's communication and collaboration, and the town can play a facilitative role in that.
And if I could just jump in, we have a redevelopment project that the CPDC will be hearing on December 14th that is doing exactly that. It's the former bridal shop at 258 Main Street. Mm-hmm. They've had some preliminary discussions with the board, and one of the comments from one of the members was maybe see if you can combine with another parcel, and that's in fact what they ended up doing. So they're going to be redeveloping two parcels, the property they own, and I think they have the option on the second parcel to now make this a commercial, vibrant economic engine for that corner of South Main Street that has been sitting there with the vacant property and not adding much. And it's interesting, we just got a comment from one of the neighbors, because in the legal ad it said mixed multi-unit, multi-something, and it wasn't multi-family, but they misinterpreted and thought it was residential. And they're very upset to think that residential would be in the building. It's strictly all commercial. So it's interesting how there's a couple different schools of thought about, is it a good thing to have residential mixed use in South Main Street, or should we be thinking more, at least down that end, further away from the commuter rail station? Should we be thinking about preserving that commercial? But in any event, parcel consolidation is tremendously important and something that we do some of right now, but expanding that, especially that South Main Street corridor, there are some parcels that really are ripe for redevelopment, and by combining parcels, it really really yields you something much grander.
But that person did it on their own. Was there any help from the town in consolidating, or that was
no,
just a market-driven?
Well, the planning board recommended that they pursue that. And I don't know exactly how the mechanics of it worked out, but they came back to us with a plan that showed the two parcels. And they, when we talked to them, they said, yeah, after the town said that, we thought, yeah, that's a good idea, and they went and did it.
John, under 5A, the text on page 49 says, gaps may exist for pre-development work, such as infrastructure related to the development and for parking. consider sharing a portion of development and infrastructure costs by being a partner on infrastructure improvements. Is there specific infrastructure you feel is lacking? You're talking about gas, you're talking about widening of streets. What are we talking about here?
Yes, there's actually a map, I believe it's in the appendices, that pertains to connectivity infrastructure and connectivity improvements that could be prioritized.
Okay.
It may be embedded in one of the summaries from one of the public meetings. But yes, we can be more specific here if you'd like about.
You know what you're referring, you're talking about the connectivity infrastructure?
Yes, connectivity, but also particularly PDA number 3, there are some real circulation improvements that could happen.
Yeah, okay.
With redevelopment, there was complete redevelopment involving multiple parcels.
Are we talking about gas line extensions, or is that not explicitly?
We did not call out gas line. It's more sort of, you know, sidewalks,
surface roads,
circulation within the site.
Good enough.
One thing I would add that I did not call in our presentation is that on page 26, there's a table summarizing our development scenarios modeling estimates. So our data services staff use a mapping tool, and we used your existing assessor's data to identify some parcels that we thought could be suitable parcels for redevelopment. And we did some modeling based on current zoning status quo and also based on different zoning. That would provide a little bit more density to do some estimates of what could be possible in terms of square footage of commercial and additional dwelling units. So these numbers, I would just caution that these are for illustrative purposes only, and it's not a prediction of redevelopment that will occur, but it just gives a sense of, you know, what additional commercial square footage and what additional housing could be possible.
So Jennifer, in that chart, so the status quo shows what it shows. And then there's a new number in the estimated change. That is on top of the status quo number?
It's in contrast to. So, you know, build out under current zoning, that's what the left column shows.
Yes.
So at maximum. And then on the right is, you know, what's slightly different.
So under this current status quo now in PDA 1A, it's telling us that we have 37,000 additional square feet of commercial, no dwelling. So when I look to the right, are you saying we cut that commercial in half and add 100 dwelling units?
Right. So what we did was, in some cases, we used different development scenarios. So because we heard PDA 1A, people were interested in the idea of including more mixed use, we applied a development scenario model that included both dwelling units and commercial. So under that mixed use scenario, this would be the mix that would be accommodated. So we sort of played around with our modeling because we know that up to 950 additional dwelling units is possible and needed to meet the demand and what we project will be the demand the next 10-15 years. So we sort of adjusted the modeling and applied it according to that to generate the kind of housing that we think the town can accommodate.
When you say additional, I think that's throwing us off. It's a reduction. It's 37,000.
It's additional to what
you're replacing column
additional
A
to
column B.
Yeah, column A goes away and B
takes
its place.
Right.
So the interesting thing, though, and I think this is probably the reaction that you got out of somebody. I mean, the column to the right on that chart adds like 400 or 500 housing units. I think a lot of people are concerned that when you start adding that many housing units in place of, in some cases, commercial, I think they've already realized what happens. I mean,
what's the better
housing cost? Units drive up services, they drive up costs,
depends
they drive
on,
up a lot of
things. Depends on the bedrooms per unit. Is that largely?
This is what we know. I mean, this is all grounded in our findings from the residential, retail, and office market analyses. We're looking at Reading in the context of the region and what we think, based on data, what we believe is possible and what the town can support. So what we're finding, and what's also supported by your housing production plan, is that there is this need, and there is a demand for housing. So the data shows that. So I would, you know, I would say that, you know, any conversation around sort of concerns of housing need, you can point folks to look at the population and housing demand projections MAPC has done for the region.
Is it fair to say that the preponderant scheme would be 1 to 2 bedroom units and with a sprinkling of 3 bedroom?
Right. So, you know, there's always a need for multifamily housing. But yes, it's always healthy to create a mix of units appropriate to different household types. you know, Reading, one of the things that's been echoed in your master plan from 2005 is that Reading is a family-friendly residential community. So what does the town need to do to sort of, you know, advance that vision? And it's consistent, I think, with the housing production plan findings from 2015.
But in 10 years, one of the things that, you know, that we've clearly seen is doing just that. We've added many housing units and very little commercial. And the net effect of that is that, you know, we stand on the precipice of a potential operating override to provide services and pay salaries. And, and a lot of that, almost 70% of that is driven, you know, by the needs in the schools.
That's subdivisions. That's big homes.
Right.
3 and 4 bedrooms.
Oh, I got it.
Yeah.
But, you know, people will go where they can afford to live and educate their children. So there's something you have to think about there. People will come. You start putting, I mean, I'm not saying we shouldn't have additional housing units. All I'm saying is that I know that there's going to be some concerns. That's the reason you probably got that, you know, you got that question fired at you. Because I hear it out in the community.
Absolutely.
You know, another thing to emphasize is that to create the customer base that Reading wants to support these businesses that Reading wants to attract, you need the additional residential, you need that population increase to support that.
Well, Street works so. Because there's people that live there now.
Yeah.
Say that again.
Haven Street works because there's people that live there now. So you just can't say we're just going to do commercial development.
I'm not saying that.
No, but I mean, but that's the kind of.
There is a balance, though.
Right, and if it's done smartly, and the residential supports the commercial and vice versa, it could get woven in very nicely.
On the other hand, 52 units aren't what's supporting all of Haven Street, right?
No, but it's just creating a destination. It's walkable. It's it does, you know. You know, the sidewalks don't roll up at night.
Well, there are some things to consider, though. I mean, in 2005, we had a certain approach, and that approach drove a lot more residences, drove a lot more housing.
Yeah, 1,000 units.
And it did not, but two other things happened when that happened. One is our affordable housing and target for 40B, the numerator and denominator got very screwed up. To use a scientific term, and
it's pretty accurate.
So we've got that problem, and the other thing that's evident is although we added 1,000 units, we added little or no commerce in the middle of that strategy that was launched in 2005. I mean, the idea that, you know, bring the people and the businesses will come has not exactly worked out that well for us, and I'm not suggesting we, you know, lock the doors at the gates to the city and don't let anybody else in. That's not
where the housing was built, at the far edges of the town. So that's not.
I got it. I mean, we have to be very careful. We have to really think in a long-term way as we go forward with this.
I think that's why on page 26, PDAs 3 and 4 show very little housing. As we all know, industrial commercial areas.
That actually, I think, came out of the fact that when we first looked at some demonstrations in the early meetings, there was a ton of housing there, and people said, what are you doing? And there was an adjustment made, and I think wisely an adjustment was made in 3 and 4.
Again, you know, to realize the vision of any of this is going to require, you know, that identification of that team of people that will implement it, and where that central person who's sort of the steward, moving things along, where that person lives. So we have one more strategy to get through, and I know we have about 3 more minutes on this item, so I want to
we
get
have
through
you on
this
the clock. We're watching you. We're watching you.
Strategy 6, build community and activate the public realm in downtown Reading through cultural economic development and placemaking initiatives. So one of the things we know through this economic development work is that there's also this piece about community building that can't be sort of ignored. It's that really crucial piece about what builds community, what builds social cohesion, what makes people want to hang out in downtown, get to know their neighbors. So there are things that the town of Reading is already doing with festivals and Shop the Block and different things, but this strategy is around taking that to the next level. I will note that you have some great creative assets in Reading. You have the new emerging CCR group. They have a logo already. It's like the creative, am I getting it right? Creative Community, Creative?
Creative Connections Reading.
Creative Connections Reading. Also, Mass Creative, which is your statewide arts and culture advocacy group for Massachusetts. The director lives in Reading. So I don't know if you all knew that. So you have some great assets here. So this is the piece around, you know, what can the town facilitate to activate the business corridors? All of those temporary things that you do, festivals, events, open studios, all those things are part of that economy, that local economy that helps build community, promote Reading, gets Reading on the map. When you get great press coverage of things like that, that's the kind of thing that makes people to think, oh, I'll come patronize downtown Reading. So it helps to set you apart as well from other neighboring communities where you may also be feeling some competition. So those are all of the strategies. I think we wanted to end on some additional conversation around, you know, what's next and what's needed. So here's a brief summary. Funding, staffing, and public-private partnerships. Roles that are needed, that need to be filled, include convening, facilitating, marketing, organizing of programs and events. And existing organizations, boards, and commissions, and groups all have a role in stewarding that implementation. Sometimes when we do these action plans, we'll include a column in addition to the phasing. Who's the lead person in the community or lead group that's really the steward of each item? So we could think about adding that. I don't know if we have the time now to do that together, but maybe I could follow up with Jean about honing in on that and we can add that so there's more accountability. And again, this is a summary of the work that was done for the Planning Division. That review of peer communities, how they are approaching economic development staffing. And all of this is summarized.
Is there anybody in our immediate area that has a local first or a Main Streets group?
Not in the immediate area, but you know, the sustainable.
Wakefield might have a Main Streets.
Which one?
Wakefield. I think they just started.
Oh,
a Main
yeah, you're
Streets.
Right. You're right. Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Nonprofit. On page 53, Barry.
There's this organization, they're based in downtown Boston. It's called the Sustainable Business Network. They've helped many communities start local first groups, which is another approach that some communities take. The town could be in touch with them and consult with them and get some TA from them, technical assistance, if you're interested in exploring things like that. But I know that some of these responsibilities, you know, the current chamber, you know, does some of this. So.
A lot of those Main Streets and organizations, they tend to sort of bolster the interests and the needs of existing businesses. But there were, when I went through the summary of all the different towns, it seemed that the ones that were focusing on bringing new business to town tended to be staff dominated. There was a staff person that was sort of running the show on that. And again, I made notes to it, but I can't find it.
I think Beverly is one of those, and they've done a lot. And I think that they drive the bus with staffing.
On page 53, I noted that as well. I don't have the name of the community offhand, but you know, one municipality, the role of the office included serving as a liaison between business owners and government entities. And helping linking them with business assistance and tax incentive programs.
So there's clearly a need to help the businesses that we have already here to thrive and to do better. But that's a different agenda and a different to-do list than it is than bringing new businesses into town. And so that's a, you know, a different skill set and different funding. And I think, you know, while we certainly can always do more to help our existing businesses, I think the focus here is just sort of, you know, marketing Reading to outsiders to come in.
We do need a first do no harm kind of a policy. In other words, we're not going to do anything that's disruptive to the current stakeholders.
That's a tricky one.
Yeah, this is a tricky one. Getting back to the point, sometimes clustering things together actually makes them all thrive
right.
over
right.
direct competitors. So there's definitely a balance that's out there that
restaurants.
You can easily. I think see, you know, making it work, I guess it's not as easy.
You know, one of the big arguments that was used
the Addison Wesley site when it was proposed for a business was said, well, we don't want to do that because it's going to kill our downtown. That was.
Yeah, we just heard from the businesses last week that was hurting them out in Linfield.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, here it is, if you bring in business and then you lose a business, where's your net? But how to construct the type of businesses that come that actually complement, you know, that's a strategic endeavor.
So, what do you see as, how can the board help you through the next steps?
I think what probably needs to happen is we need to think about what things should we be prioritizing, and the plan has a series of things that we should be doing sooner than later. And putting our heads around what can we accomplish? What can we tackle as things that we can actually get done? And who's going to be the we to do that?
That'll be you. Well, you have somebody now.
We'll have to work on the town manager's budget about that.
I will say that 2 years ago, I challenged EDC to spend $600,000 of the permits revolving fund. Mm. We're down to maybe $400,000. There is seed money. There is one-time seed money.
That revolving fund is from where?
Three projects in town that are mostly housing. Johnson Woods, Addison Wesley, and Lara Pulte. So there is funding that it wouldn't take money out of the general fund to do this based on our circumstances, but there is an opportunity to start it up.
Well,
but it's got to be really well thought out.
Is this worth a Saturday session, Dick? Kind of put our heads together.
Not in the next month, but maybe after that. Yeah.
After you go through the budgets in January, I would say, so you get that update.
Sure. Right. Sure.
This is a pretty thick topic, and you want to spend the time to go through it as a group.
And there are peripheral things not in this presentation, other areas in town for development. I mean, just throw a name out there, Simon's Way.
Mm-hmm.
There's no reason that these folks would look at it, but you should.
The one thing that I'll go back to, because it's been on my mind a lot, is the wayfinding piece.
The what?
Wayfinding. I think that one thing that we could really think a lot about and make some improvements on that wouldn't be too complicated is to use our signage network to more effectively highlight where the parking is. Mm-hmm. We did some upgrades a few years ago, but if you're driving down 28 and just passing through and say, oh, there's a such and such store, and you think about it too late, the opportunity to stop and park has already gone by if you don't know where the parking is.
Are there any apps that like Woos or anything like
Waze.
That?
Waze.
Waze. Waze. Waze.
But
if you're Woos, you can't drive.
No. But Waze will find you.
You have to have someone in the car with you.
Waze finds you speed traps, I guess, but can find you parking.
But for that, you know, occasional trade that's just, we've got 20,000 cars a day going up and down Main Street that probably aren't that familiar with what's here. And with a better signage network and some wayfinding improvements, that could be something that could solve some problems right there.
Yeah.
An arts and culture would actually be an interesting thing to integrate into that.
Yeah.
Sure. A what?
Arts and culture. There's a way to creatively approach wayfinding, but Malden actually is a community that's done that. They were able to get a famous artist to work with them on their wayfinding signage if they're walking out.
There is a grant out there, I don't know if, I think it's due Friday. So,
what was the grant
at? There's a remote possibility that we might shoot for that. The Mass Downtown Initiative does have a small pot of money to have a consultant come in and design something.
Sure.
But the flip side of that is, I don't even know if we need a consultant to come in and design something.
Yeah.
We're talking about telling people that Haven Street has a bunch of stuff down there.
Yeah. What do you need is an archway.
You mean a sign that says Downtown Shopping District, next left?
Something kind of to Jen's point, like, something kind of unique.
Don't let it be electric. We save that for Wilmington.
Don't miss the next left turn. You'll regret it.
Something that would brand it and be something.
Yeah, with a sandwich board.
I keep thinking about the arched in Providence. When you go to Federal Hill in Providence, you know you're there because that arch tells you that. It's not a big sign. It's something that's architectural that conveys there's something going on.
Yeah.
Something walk over. Possibly. Then you could cross over 28.
That works.
Side ordinance.
We have some creative people in writing that could probably help with that designing.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Very good. Any further questions to the board? Any comments from the audience before our guests leave tonight? If not, I'd like to thank the two of you for some really diligent and high-quality work.
Excellent work.
Yeah. We look forward to continuing the partnership with our board and your work.
Thank you.
Thank you,
John. Thanks, Jennifer.
Thanks.
Good stuff.
Want to call a brief break?
Yeah, absolutely.
About 5 minutes. We'll reconvene at just 8:43. So is 1A.
Yeah, true. Yeah. I think 1A is kind of galloped up.
The what?
Galloped up.
The, well, the area's along Main Street out there. Might need some more.
Right. Quite a bit across from the, yeah. Across from.
Yeah, there was a conceptual plan drawn as part of the work of setting up and down and rebuilding it and having office space there in addition.
I guess you're, I think I see Jane Parentel and Hamid, what's your last name?
Yes, Jafari.
Jafari, welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, Colleen, why don't you go ahead?
Thank you for having us for our biannual update. Don't want to be redundant to the recent town meeting, so we have a couple of different topics to go over. Kind of went over some of these peak performance highlights. As I mentioned at the annual report, the peak performance is our kind of our model for this year. Last year was more of a get greener, be efficient, and go paperless, and those campaigns have been pretty successful going forward. But just to recap, we completed the organizational reliability studies. We're in the process of change management on implementing those recommendations. We created a grid modernization, implementing a new GIS right now. Davies Company is out there collecting all the data. Installing a new AMI mesh network. Currently, there's a fixed network for the metering system. And so for the 500 Club, we went to a mesh network, which is a better two-way communication method in order to be able to communicate with our larger customers. Peak reduction programs and technology and maintaining the reliability indices. Performing the cost of service study, which I had mentioned at the annual report update. Unbundled our rates, we added the low income rate and the LED streetlight rate. Of course, I mentioned before, we did get the LED streetlight and the electric vehicle charging station grants. We've installed two such electric vehicle charging stations in Wilmington so far, but not in Reading. But we still have the rebate and the incentive programs on that. External, internal communications programs that we've been working with right now. Internally, we had been talking, you know, with Bob and the fire, police, and all of the towns about possibly using a 911 look for the code red for ourselves. But we also had a little challenge at work with customer service, and we went from 5,000 emails and texts to 17,000 within 1 year. So we were able to avoid those costs of going to a code red, and I think we're going to continue in that path. We recently sent out our new online store through our new communications program. So this paperless seems to be going really well, and people seem to be excited. We got a lot of feedback on our new, our first digital in-brief that got sent out. And customers actually called and said, oh, it was kind of nice to get it in an email form. And I think they're starting to appreciate the us not using as much paper. 6-year capital and expense projects in budgets and that we've continued for the last year and a half seem to be going really well. And then allowing us to, you know, plan ahead and be able to provide the town's input for budgeting, which I will do later in the presentation. As far as the efficiency and peak reductions, and if you have any questions on engineering operations and needs here, and Jane as well, and integrated resources, we're putting upgraded and put together an awful lot of brand new programs to address peak and also to help to offset the capacity and transmission costs, which I've mentioned a couple of times in the last year and a half, that they are coming down the pike. Those capacity costs are predominantly to pay for the Salem Harbor station that's being renovated over there. And unfortunately, FERC, you know, sends out all the costs and we all have to get our allocated piece and pay our share. But Jane, do you want to just mention what the costs are for transmission capacity?
Yeah, the current cost for capacity, our costs are about $3 a kilowatt month, and that's anticipated to increase fivefold to $15 a kilowatt month because we're located in the NEMA or the Northeast Massachusetts zone. As Colleen had mentioned, Footprint Power is rebuilding where Salem Harbor used to be, and that was the clearing unit for capacity constraints, so that's coming into effect in 16-17, so we have to get our share of those costs as well as all of the constituents in this region, in the Boston and Northeast Mass region. Transmission is increasing annually on the rate of 6 to 10%. FERC in their need to upgrade the infrastructure for transmission. A lot of power plants are being built in Maine, and that power needs to go to the source where they're located in centralized cities like Boston and Connecticut. So all of New England, all of the seven New England states have to share that cost. And so currently those costs are, we're paying about $90 a kilowatt a year for that. And that's based on our monthly peak demand.
Jan, did you say something was tripling from 5 to 15? Can you go over that again?
Yeah, that's our capacity costs. Right now, in order to maintain the reliability within the New England region, ISO New England is the centralized clearing zone for the seven New England states. So they have an auction every year for capacity, and they develop market rules in order to ensure that everybody's power will stay on to maintain the reliability of the region. So they do an auction every 3 years going out, and currently those costs were done 3 years ago. Right now our costs, in 2000 there was about 10,000 megawatts of new generation that was built, and those have since retired or been taken out of the market. So Footprint Power was the latest one to clear in that market, and that set the clearing price at $15 a kilowatt.
So that's a small component of the rate the ratepayer pays, but that's going to cause the ratepayer rates
an
to
increase,
go up?
Correct.
You know about what percent?
We currently anticipate for the next fiscal year around a 7 to 9% increase for our average customer. Power supply represents around 75 to 80%. It's a pass-through, so we don't make any return on that. We just, secure the contracts and pass those through.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
What Jane just mentioned is on the slide, and I'd like to shoot Bob over a copy of it. So as Jane said, about out of an $80 million budget, 75% is the power supply pass-through, and what Jane's speaking of, the capacity of the transmission, is all through the pass-through. So whenever we get charged, we have to pass that along. There is no money that's being made on that. By law, we're allowed to make 8% of net plant on the expense side. Well, not the expense side, but the operating side, which is about 25%. And that money is typically just used to make the commitments, the return on investment, the new tax payments, and things of that nature. As Jane mentioned, the 7 to 9%. Now, what we had committed to last year was when we have this update in December, we would give you this preliminary information, and then we'll refine it going forward. And then in the spring, when I give another update, we'll try to give you exactly what's going to be happening effective July 1st. But the 7 to 9% increase is the overall bill. Out of that, about 2% is an increase on the operational expense, and the 5 to 7% is on the pass-through on the capacity and transmission. So we'll give you a better update probably in the spring, but that looks like what we're heading towards. And not just us, it's unfortunately everyone. But the good news is we're still, double-digit percentage less than the IOUs. I mean, they've already gone up 38%, and they're still increasing, and Red and Light is still one of the lowest rates in the state.
This rate setting happens every 3 years, you said?
I'm sorry?
Did I understand that there's
just a portion of the change?
Okay. The 5 to 7%, how often is that set? How often is that assessment made, that capacity assessment done? How often is that done? You described earlier that there was an auction every 3 years.
Yeah, there's an auction every year going 3 years out. So
I
it's
see.
A rolling
so
out.
Every year window done every year. Okay.
Correct.
All right.
Right.
Thank you.
But the 7 to 9% is the overall increase.
This year.
For this coming
year. For this
great.
Coming year.
Great.
Of which 2% is what you would probably consider the variable cost as opposed to the pass-through cost. The grid modernization supports the efficiency, two-way communications, accuracy, reliability, and safety. This is a little mind-blowing. I showed this before, but we didn't really have a chance to look at it at the annual report. But on the left-hand side, you can see the mesh network and the fixed network on the meters. Down below, you can see the automation that will be on the switches on the pole. Okay, it communicates in through the firewall to our fiber loop, and then comes over to our control central, which will be integrating your advanced meter infrastructure, your outage management system, your SCADA automation control system, and it integrates all of them. And basically, we use a service bus to integrate them, so if one of the systems has to be maintained, the other systems won't be disrupted, so they're not a point-to-point. This is what we would probably, we call it grid modernization. It's not a smart grid, it's more of like an IntelliGrid. It meets the requirements of the DPU for all of the utilities having to have some type of modernization. But we're very dedicated to making sure that we meet the same mantras of the efficiency and the communication with the customers. The intent of the automation is for the switches to sense faults and to talk to each other, and then, you know, the power will be restored, the linemen get called, and they go out and they fix the actual problem. But quickly, you'll be able to isolate the fault. And that's kind of the, you know, the intent of it. In a larger scale on the larger feeders, we're not getting down to the side streets. But some of the interesting things, you can put fault detectors in, which, I mean, you can count, you know, 1,200 feet, if it says 1,200 feet, and you will find a squirrel on the ground right there at 1,200 feet. So those things save an awful lot of time when you consider, you know, 10 years ago, you have linemen patrolling braided cable for hours and days trying to find a little pinhole that might be causing a fault or causing the circuit to operate. So a lot has done, and, you know, Hamid's done a great job with designing this and saving a lot of money by having that in-house talent.
Tell me, what's the cost of that capital?
For the smart grid itself? Well, it's in the budget. We can go through the line items of the budget, or I can send it to you, but so like the AMI piece is separate from the GIS. So we're building the GIS. That's about $500,000 is for collecting all of the data and redoing the entire GIS so that there's 100% accuracy. The 500 club meters, which were already budgeted years ago, but I stopped it because it didn't have a two-way communication. How much of the? About $100,000.
Are you tracking all the poles, including the ones you don't own, that the telecom people own?
Actually, we do own all of the poles. 50-50.
Oh, you do?
50.
Oh.
The ownership is 50-50.
Okay.
You're probably talking about the maintenance area.
Okay.
And I actually have a map in here that I can show you. But from a maintenance standpoint,
okay,
we're collecting everything. And all of our maintenance programs are actually looking at everything. For example, pole inspections. We did the pole inspections for our poles. We're doing a certain percentage every year that's required. But they're not really doing them on the Verizon side. But we care about poles that might fall and hurt someone around here. So we're actually doing a lot of the work out there. And
that's when you see the chopped off pole that's kind of joined up to the one you put in. Yeah.
I figured you'd be asking me about double poles, so I added that in there.
Double poles.
The automated switches, a switch costs about $40,000.
About $35,000.
We got one or two a year that we're buying. So it's not like a smart grid, millions of dollars. It's more of the pieces that are getting put together, and it's a 5 to 20 year program. Okay?
What do you think your total capital spend is this year on grid modernization? What's your capital equipment outlay this year?
The capital equipment outlay is about $10 million this year, but $2 million of it was not spent last year, and $2 million from last year, so that brings it down to $8 million, and then there's $2 million just for a we're looking at this concept of for peak reduction. Distributed generator, which is a small gas-fired unit.
Understood.
So when you hit the button, it's 2.5 megawatts. We're trying to combine that type with, you know, this tangent program that we're using for a peak reduction, where we ask our customers to curtail their load when we give the signal, or tangent, the company we're working with, they give a signal, and if they drop, we share the benefit of reducing the peak, because that's where your premium cost is during the day. So we're working with our customers. So we have a number of different things that we're trying to address the cost to offset that capacity and transmission that Jane had spoken about.
It's kind of hard to tease apart the sustainment piece from the modernization piece. At some level, they blend into each other. Improving the load maintenance blends into the overall, like the communication improvements you described earlier.
Right.
So it's about $8 million a year in total
right.
CapEx.
Right.
This may be a little off topic. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
We hear, and this is maybe more of a generic countrywide concern, is there any practical way to harden our systems against things like EMPs that could happen? You know, if there's an electromagnetic pulse that could take out large sections of our power grid.
Right.
Is anybody at any level thinking about how to defend against that?
We have, by law, have to follow the NERC in cybersecurity.
The NERC?
National Energy Regulatory Committee. Okay. And they have cybersecurity rules that we have to follow, and we're challenged on them almost daily, and we have all of these regulations and procedures that we have to fill out. We have to respond back and forth, and we have someone that follows that on a daily basis.
Is that
basis.
Hacking, or is that, you know, damage from a burst of radiation?
The NERC identifies where you are susceptible or where you can be susceptible, and then they're sent out and they're called SIPs. I mean, there's a lot of different acronyms, but we have to respond to that. Like, what are we doing to prevent that?
Yep.
And what are we doing, you know, fire, like the picture of the firewalls. Mm-hmm. There's all different things that we have to do in order to meet the requirements of NERC. Mm-hmm. But it is almost a daily, full-time job just tracking those type of requirements that have been imposed on the electric industry for probably, what, the last 4 or 5 years?
Yes.
Yeah. It's pretty intense.
Okay, that's good to hear.
But, John, to answer your question, it's not $8 million for, I mean, I don't have the budget with me.
Well, it's really poking at it. How much is the pure modernization versus fixing what's already there, or you know, the transformers burned out, get a new transformer? How much is it focused on the modernization aspect?
We're spending approximately $500,000.
A year?
Yeah.
And what's the total spend to build out the whole modernization plan?
In order to do that, if over the 10 to 15 years, it's going to cost about $25 to $30 million.
Over 20 years, yeah. Because a lot of that capital is like, you know, we buy bulk transformers. There's a lot of capital material and everything that's in that budget. But as Hamid said, probably about $500,000 on the GIS, because they're all the components. So when we say grid modernization, building out the GIS is part of grid modernization.
It is. You don't see it as a physical asset. It's kind of an intellectual property thing, right? I get it.
I'm trying. There's accountants of the world that sit and debate GIS and tangible assets and non-tangible
right.
assets all day long. And it is an interesting concept of where it falls in the accounting world. But anyway, so the switches themselves are about 35, and we have about 6 or 7 that we'll be putting in. But the good thing is we have talent in-house, and a lot of this stuff is being done in-house. We're not hiring consultants to do the design. We're able to write the bid specifications ourselves. We're able to handle all the technical. So when you really look at it, and it says $20 million over 10 years, if we didn't have the in-house talent, it would probably cost about $100 million. So yay us. just a little bit more on the efficiency and peak. I mentioned the rate of the low income and the LED streetlight rate. We have the controlled water heater program that's back up and running again. If you have a electric hot water heater and you're not in this program, give us a call. We have material on the shelf, and we're ready to come out there and get you hooked up. The time of use rate probably saves the typical 1,000 kilowatt hour customer about $15 to $20 a month by changing creature habits and in using more of the electricity off peak time periods. The community solar we've mentioned, it's a replacement for Green Choice. We're still in the process of trying to work with a consultant to look at an RFP to see, you know, who we're going to use, how we're going to do this to come up with the best packages that help both the RMLD and the customer. The solar policy, while we do all these different programs, we have to keep in mind the whole electrical engineering part and the stabilization of the grid itself. So we don't want to have too much solar on one feeder, because we don't want to, you know, cause a destabilization of the system itself. So while we want to have solar, we have to make sure that it's placed to make sure that the system's protection coordination still stays intact and we still have a safe system. From distributed generation, I talked about that peaking unit. We were also looking at battery storage and solar.
Your initial community solar is going up in Wilmington, is that true? Are you partnering?
Yeah, well, yeah. We're working with all four towns. I mean, everybody's kind of at a different stage, and we wrote the RFP to kind of look at, there's so many different solar companies that come in, and there's so many different packages that they can put together. And it really depends on what building you're looking at, on what piece of land you're looking at, which way does it face. So it's kind of like a case by case. So we're offering it to all four towns, and whoever wants to do it we want to work with them, but we want to be able to give them a consultant that will give them the best package. But there's nothing planned for Wilmington. I think we're just providing a list of potential areas in all four towns except Linfield, right? I'm not sure Linfield. Did Linfield provide town buildings to look at?
Yes, they did.
Oh, they did. Yeah. Okay. So all four towns are provided.
You have about half of Linfield or three quarters?
We do half of Linfield,
half,
yes. Yeah. Yep. Okay, so on to the LED streetlights. What I have up there in the yellow is the pilot program that was approved, and that those all got installed, and we got great feedback. We didn't get any negative feedback. We got a couple of lights that they wanted redirected and tilted, which was easy to do. So for the next 3 years, and this is also in the capital plan, to do the full implementation. So if you look at the blue thing, the blue square, it's 2450 lights each year for 3 years. So whatever is listed for Reading, like 815 would be times three. That would be the total amount of lights. So we've done 222 so far. We are calculating what the savings is going to be, and then at the end of the year we'll send Bob a note saying this is what the credit is, and we'll try to do it quarterly going forward as we get really going on these light replacements. Just a reminder, the $250,000 for the street light grant, $125,000 was for municipals, and the other $125,000 was for commercial and residential. This is where we're getting the money to buy the light bulbs that we're offering for half off and the holiday string lights that are on the online store, and we have all the rebate programs for commercial customers and the residential customers. So if you need those type of auditing done, give us a call. We got lots of programs online now. Can you see the numbers here? I put this up here because I thought maybe you would ask me what the savings are on the LED streetlights. So we start off with the high-pressure sodium, which is what you had presently, and we go all the way to the other end where there's a... Gene showed me how to do the pointer here. So we start off with the HPSs, the high-pressure sodiums, and what light count you did have, the energy used, the kilowatt hours, the formula rate, and then based on that, how much it was costing for the town, okay? The proposed LED lights, then, you can see the savings in the kilowatt hours, the cost to the town, and the annual savings over the high-pressure sodiums was approximately $44,000.
Looks now, like we shouldn't change out the 50-watt ones.
Yeah, good catch. Now, a couple of things happened. One was that the reason why that is negative right there, and I had mentioned this last year, unfortunately, the previous streetlight rate done a while ago, years ago, did not capture the capital cost. So the way you can look at this is that everyone got a bargain for their lights for years, because there was no capital. So when we redid the rate, and Jane's group redid the rate, now we're capturing the capital. So that's what makes the high-pressure sodium 50s to the 25-watt LEDs not much of a savings. But look at all the savings you got from years before that. But the other ones, definitely. So it gets a little bit to sink in, but I have more analysis if you want it, Bob, but that's kind of just a snapshot of what the savings are. More efficiency and peak measures, as I said, the commercial lighting rebate, the initiative program, it's almost like having your own engineering team. That's how good the group is. So for any of the commercial customers and even the residential, when you call, I mean, we walk you through almost everything. So it is like having free engineering analysis to help all of the commercial customers. And I know we were talking about economic development earlier, and it really is a great incentive to have a municipal light plant with the low rates, the reliability, and also a team of engineers that essentially is part of what you pay in your rate to help support, you know, looking at the efficiency of your commercial or your house for that matter, and making the right choices, laying out what the cost would be over a plan for you. So they really do a nice detailed work, Jane and her group.
Colleen, one of the things we look at on our side is, which is similar to what we're chatting about here, is the demand for water. And the reality of our side is that conservation efforts have caused water use per household to have a marked drop over the last dozen years. It's really, although it's flattened out a bit, the trend is still towards additional conservation.
Right.
Do you see the same thing on your side with improvement in lighting, with the improvement in appliance efficiency? You seem to be saying earlier that demand is actually going up. Kilowatt hours consumed per household is on its way up. I would have thought.
Actually, it's fairly flat. What we're seeing is we want everyone to use electricity off peak. The solar and the LED streetlights, there's a lot of things that, you know, hurt the sales when we're in the business of selling electricity. And by shifting off of the peak, we're able to balance that a little bit. I mean, the economic development and the load growth would be great. I mean, we do have pockets in Wilmington that are still growing. We have a new substation that we'll be building there within a couple of years. We would love to see behind RMLD built up. We would love to see, server farms in there and somebody just crank up the juice all day long.
Let's talk about that for a minute, because I thought that you had a very well thought out comment. They passed the comments around from the economic development, and so yours was there.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
And you heard what you heard. You know, you sat through most of that. How do you feel about that back there? I mean, I know we're a little off topic, but not that much off topic as far as development in and around the physical plant that you guys operate in now. I mean,
I don't know.
Should you be in a smaller space, bigger space? I mean,
well,
what
do
you
think? Well, I was going to ask that question if you're able to, care to answer. Are you contemplating moving somewhere?
What we've been doing over there is, and as I mentioned to Bob, we have a master site plan that we will be doing, okay? But you really can't address the master site plan if you haven't done a spring cleaning in forever, okay? So we have a document control that we're looking at. We're going to be, you know, we have to follow the laws. We have to log everything, but we're going to be shredding. We're looking at, you know, we rent the Barbas's area, you know, how much stuff in there. Needs to be surplused and moved out so that we can say, okay, this is exactly the amount of space that we need for inventory and all of our storage. The other thing I was mentioning in that comment is you have tractor-trailer trucks that do a lot of deliveries. We have our transformers delivered, wire delivered. You know, we have poles that are delivered someplace else, but we don't have enough substations to store everything remotely.
Right.
So you need to have that egress in the turning radius for your tractor-trailer trucks that are coming in. You also need to look at the safety for the CDL trucks that are running in and out all day long. And I was just, one of the comments I was mentioning was just that I thought the second concept that was laid out that had us in the back and possibly the trucks egressing or exiting out the other way was a great thing. I mean, we can consolidate for sure. And if we're on multi-levels, I know it would be nice to have us all together, but right now we're almost in a building that has, you know, four fiefdoms that would be great for doctors that meet in the cafeteria once a year. So there's definitely some ergonomics to, you know, improving the culture, the corporate culture, and the communication within the RMLD. Whether that means going to a small space in a couple of levels would be great as well. I've been back there, you know, I've worked with Mr. Barbas. I think it's a wonderful area to have technological park or something.
Well, I mean, especially you start to think about the rate. I mean, you know, we've got the best rates in the Commonwealth.
Yeah.
And you
I
know,
thought
you,
the mixed use was nice. I liked.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen that building in Danvers where you have multi use in it, but it has still has a colonial aesthetic look to it. I think that's really nice.
Yeah.
One of the other comments was walking, you know, getting to the train, and if we could work with the train and have a boardwalk, I mean, you could get from that area,
yeah,
and maybe we can have, you know, little cafe or something with RMLD or whatever,
boardwalk,
and then you
yeah
walk down to Haven Street, and you maybe you have a triangulation of three different economic
mm-hmm
areas for shopping or for whatever. I mean, you know, maybe you have professional staff working that way, and they're able to walk up. I love walking up, but I'll tell you, when I get to the end of Ash Street, and
yeah, it's
I just don't know what to do.
Yeah.
I go like this, and I run, you know? I mean, it is a little bit.
The cars don't know what to do either.
The cars don't know what to do either.
They park on the tracks. What do you
Trains definitely know what to do.
My youngest one's getting her license, and she drove me to work Sunday when we came for the lighting, which is beautiful, by the way. And some lucky people won the ugly sweater. We were running the ugly sweater down on Haven Street. But she's like, no, Mom, I'm never driving you to work again. I can't. She can't do that corner.
Yeah,
you know, the
yeah
back loop,
yeah,
you know,
yeah
coming. She's like, I'm all set.
Mm-hmm. So is that, do you think that out the back, I mean, there's a temporary cut through now, isn't there? Or during the railroad?
I think when the railroad was shut
when
down,
they were working
they
on the bed there for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's possible, and I think the idea in people's head is there. Maybe, Mr. Barbas, were you part of connecting that roadway between when the railroad was shut down for a bit?
Just temporarily.
Yeah. But you didn't notice anything different. I think DPW came through and
yeah
other trucks, but
that was it.
Yeah. Seemed to
it just seems like, you know, there's a lot of possibilities down there. I mean, I don't know the right answer, but
what I heard from the public that came to the meetings, they were more than willing to see that area built up and made to look nicer. Not to say your building isn't beautiful, but I think, you know, there's a lot of potential there, as you said.
As long
and
as the additional traffic wasn't all coming out on Dash Street.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And RMLD is willing to, you know, we're flexible. Like I said, we just
yeah
need to maintain our operations, and we just don't want to give the public the impression, you know, we're not in the truck business, because we are. And
yeah
we are in the delivery business.
That's really the
we
biggest
are
challenge, isn't it,
yeah
the trucks?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we can, I think we get along wonderful with the neighborhood right now. And, you know, when we do have trucks coming in and out, and I think we do a good job with that. I wouldn't want to make it really pretty there and have people under the impression that that wouldn't continue.
Yeah.
You know, that's all. Just want to be realistic.
Hmm.
So, from our economic development standpoint, it isn't RMLD's objective to, you know, try to tell any of the four towns what they need to do, but we are reaching out and saying, can we be part of the economic development so that we can help you?
Yeah.
And I did make mention that I think, you know, Jay and Hamid, we did a pretty good job in bringing Osram into Wilmington. And I think offering the low rates and the services and the initiatives that we do really did help that. And I think we can do that.
That is an asset that we're not selling properly
yeah
to a larger
yeah
commercial developer.
Right.
I don't know if you heard Bob's comments earlier in the evening, but we are working very hard with North Reading to supply MWRA
yes
water, which will, I think, enable some development to happen up there.
Yeah.
Well,
that
new
that
customers
would be good.
Yeah.
That would be good. There are a couple, though, that I heard when I got here that escaped, and I wish I was here.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have let them escape, so I don't know if I could get them back, but we're trying. So, these are just some of the major capital improvements that we did this past year in Reading. Some cable replacements and flexibility for contingency backup power, the LED street lights and everything. But, you know, I can pass along, and Bob has a copy of the budget. It gets into a lot more detail. We did start a new proactive maintenance program. There wasn't a lot of maintenance. I mean, I'm not hiding that from everyone, but we had to develop new maintenance programs, and we are actively implementing some major maintenance, including generating the new tech services group. Didn't have a substation maintenance group, and we develop that group, and we're training each of the technicians similar to a lineman. There'll be a journeyman program, and we want to be able to have that talent in-house so we can do all of our maintenance ourselves. But you'll probably see people around doing manhole inspections. The tree trimming program has been revamped. Porcelain cutouts, quarterly inspections. I mean, we have a lot going on. And the pole testing. Unfortunately, the pole testing, when we find condemned poles, anything that was dangerous, we replaced immediately. But you'll see more double poles. As we go through and we have all of these circuits that we're upgrading, or if the pole test doesn't come out right, we have to install the pole. But I know that you're concerned about double poles because they are not very attractive. So I added this. This is a map of the brown section is where in Reading where RMLD has its maintenance, and the green section is Verizon. I did mention that Verizon has been getting out of the pole business in other parts of the country. More on that to come. Something to think about. So on the right-hand side, though, there really wasn't a tracking mechanism, and now we're involved in what's called engines. And what engines does is basically ball and cord. So when you put in a new pole, electric has to transfer, and then Comcast, and then fire, and then cable TV, you know, and it goes on until the last person in the maintenance area, whether you're brown or green, pulls the pole. So if a new pole is needed, it's the maintenance person, and when at the end the pole that gets pulled is the maintenance person. In between that, everybody has to make their transfers. So tonight, before we came here, I had the guys do as much work as they could so we could look really super when I showed you where we were with Reading. So we did have 7 pole pulls, which got done by the end of the day, and now we're down to 1. So you can see, you know, Comcast has 1, the fire department has 8, Reading Light has 25, and Verizon has 31 out of 65 double pulls. Now I will tell you, this engines is new. It's a great way of tracking. We're trying to reach out to the fire departments and Comcast, make sure everybody just keeps the transfers moving. But with Davies doing the GIS, we are collecting all of the data to make sure that this is accurate, because we don't know how accurate Verizon's is. So we are working to make this accurate. So I will be probably giving Bob updates this probably quarterly so that we have so we can keep track of the double poles and you can see how we're progressing. Career development and training. As I said, we have talent management going on through the organizational study. Lots of changes happening, lots of training happening, and so we're moving through that. It is, as I said in the annual report, when you're climbing that peak, some people look at it as a challenge and other people look at it as exhausting. So we want to keep forging forward and making sure that all of our employees have the skill sets that are necessary to keep themselves safe and the public.
Colleen, what's your full-time employment right now?
Full-time employment, I think, is about 73. At one point, it was almost 90. We have about 6 or 7 vacancies, mm-hmm. But there's some vacancies that I'm a little hesitant to fill right now until the organizational restructure recommendations are. I mean, right now, like Jane's group, for example, got renamed to Integrated Resources. Customer service is now gone from the business end over to Integrated Resources because we're going to be spending more time on working hand in hand with the customers on programs. So there's a lot going on, but we're making it happen. Does that answer your question?
Thank you.
Okay. The end result for the organizational recommendation, I believe, is 77.
What do you think you were 5 years ago, headcount-wise? You said it was 94. Just curious.
I wasn't here. I haven't been here that long. 5 years ago, Jane?
I would say maybe mid-80s. We've had some retirement. But to Colleen's point, though, almost half of our workforce is eligible for retirement within 5 years.
Right. The attrition number or open helps get that number. I'm trying to figure out the efficiency. We see in, for example, some of our groups, headcounts come down as the equipment gets bigger, more efficient. You don't quite need the manpower. I'm just trying to get a sense of how much more efficient the team is now than it might have been 5 or 10 years ago.
It's a lot more efficient right now. As the training and the skill sets improve, the efficiency will get even better. We are As I said, the 7 vacancies need to be filled. That's your efficiency level. We have a lot of people that are, you know, doing a lot of work, and you know that increases your overtime sometimes when you have the vacancies. But right now, with the amount of training, I mean, you can't just come in and work for RMLD. You have to learn the entire system. It takes several years to learn that. So there is a benefit right at this point for some of the vacancies. And plus with overtime, especially with the labor units, you'll always have certain people that like to come in all the time and certain people that like to go to their place up in Vermont or wherever they go. So, you know, there's always a balance. But the 77 will be based on the organizational study and based on the needs is just about right for probably no fat in everyone doing their job description and skilled at doing it with minimal to no consultants, which is pretty good. And I'm also changing all of the steps to performance-based progression. There's no more you just get a raise because you get a raise. Annual reliability indices, Katie, Sadie, Safey, these are our industries. And a lot of times managers will present these so that they look really wonderful because we are below national and regional averages. But really what we do, what we do with them is we take the data and that is where we focus our priorities for maintenance. So we actually collect the data on anything more than a minute of an outage, where a lot of the IOUs might be 5 minutes or something larger, because they really want to send the data out, you know, to their stockholders or whatever and show that they're doing well. But we're really trying to tailor our, so we really get way down with the outages and collecting the data. So what are we doing for the three major areas for equipment? The coordination study looks at the fuses that would be melting, because that even though it's melting, that's still a failure of a piece of equipment. The proactive maintenance and inspection programs, the age of the equipment. A lot of the equipment in the system is aged, and we are now have new processes of evaluating that and then replacing them on a schedule. New transformer load replacement program. For the trees, we have the new tree trimming program with Mayer. It's a 3-year cycle. We pay by span. And I am very happy with that program. So we've beefed up communications with the tree warden and the assistant tree warden and the Conservation Commission, and we're having continuous process improvement meetings. I think that's going splendidly. And then for the wildlife, we have increased animal guards. I mean, they just can get in nooks and crannies, whether it's the span of a hawk or the tail to the nose on a squirrel. It's just part of the business, but if we can, you know, sometimes you put up these animal guards and, you know, it might not let a squirrel in, but next thing you know, you have birds moving in because it makes the perfect little birdhouse. So we're constantly evaluating how to keep the animals from causing outages. And thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank
questions,
you.
Final? Yes, Bob.
First, Dave Mancuso emailed me just before tonight and apologized for not being here at a business function. He's your CFP.
Thank you.
And also, just to tie a couple bows together that hadn't been said explicitly, Gene was telling you earlier about Dr. Raven's work. Colleen has been great in terms of being flexible, as she just described, in terms of her space. And that's what caused all that stuff to be able to happen, for us to be able to attack, you know, the priority development area 3, especially from Ash Street, from Main Street. So Colleen deserves a lot of credit for being very flexible on the future of the RMLD space. Without that, it wouldn't have made any sense to even go down that path.
I think, though, at this juncture, we really have to work closely together, because I don't want to move forward on our buildings if the town wants to take a different direction. So I don't know if we're holding each other up, but
you're not holding us up.
Okay. Well, I'm holding myself up then, you know, because what is it, 232 Ash Street, Station 1?
Is that the historic
That's building? The historic building. Right now, like I said, we're getting rid of, there's paper in there, documents and equipment, and we're moving all of that stuff out. You know, we redid the HVAC. I mean, some of the capital, $500,000 this year was to redo half of the HVAC system in the building, so the other half has to be done. And I purposely did it over 2 years so that if we were going to
you know, be moving or something like that. I was kind of hoping we could lift it off the building and put it on another building.
So does the historic building become a surplus asset for you?
I don't know. I mean, at the beginning, I was thinking that, you know, maybe we would rent out the existing building and we move into that and put a breezeway in for a, you know, a meeting area, and then just add on to where the line operations is and just kind of consolidate that way. They had done a study before I got there on the renovations to that historic building. It's pretty costly, but I think at the end, you know, it would probably make sense. But given this new conceptual with the economic development, you know, that might take a different course if it would be better if we were out back and out front was able to be more of a mixed use. I mean, mm-hmm. we want to play into whatever is going to provide for the best economic development for the town and for us, you know, because it's our golden egg. You know, we want to feed it.
As you heard tonight, I think we're still walking through the right way to get this launched and get it initiated and getting the right human resources in place to manage it,
right.
You know, beyond even this board's tenure. So I very much appreciate your willingness to work with this board as we get through it. I think it's really a teamwork kind of a concept. RMLD is one of our crown jewels,
right.
of the town. We'd like to keep it that way. We very much appreciate the working environment. So.
Okay. Yep. I just want to be cautious as to, you know, the maintenance on the buildings in going forward, because I have to have that master site plan is going to look at best usage and what needs to be done to each of the buildings. And like, you know, the operations building, it's been a long time, I think, since anything's been done to that building. So if it needs to be renovated or if it needs to be...
That's the historic building? The
no, the operations building, where the linemen sit, where all the trucks are.
I see.
You know, like if we were to look at efficiency, and we just did a fleet study, you know, would it make sense for us to have, you know, shared maintenance? Or should we at least have someone there that does oil changes and stuff? But there's equipment that's in the building that's like lifts and stuff that's long past the age of its life. And it would cost a lot of money to fix it. So we fix it or are we not fixing
right.
it? So
right.
we're at that juncture, I think, in the buildings of a decision has to be made as to whether or not the money needs to be spent. So it's kind of a key time for us too. But thank you very much. Thank you, Jane and Hamid, for coming
thank
to help me.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right.
Very informative. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Bob, I'll send you a copy. And
okay.
All right. I think we have one final item on the agenda. That's the hearing to amend the FY16 non-union classification plan. Mr. Secretary, would you like to read the notice?
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, please take notice that the Board of Selectmen of the town of Reading will hold a public hearing on December 1st, 2015 at 9 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Massachusetts, on amending the FY16 non-union classification plan. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on December 1st, 2015 to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us.
Thank you, Kevin. Bob?
Thank you, Dan. If you look on the chart behind me, and it was in your packet over the weekend, we're asking for two really straightforward and simple changes. We have two positions currently in grade E, assistant collector and assistant treasurer. And we had money moved at November town meeting to allow for us to do this, but we weren't in a position to ask you to do this in September when you did the others because we had a retirement pending. So we now want to go ahead and ask you to move assistant collector and assistant treasurer each up one grade to F. And just to give you a little bit of background, the treasury function, particularly in Reading, largely because of the light department, but not entirely, is different than most towns. A lot of the work they do, cash flow, cash management, wire payment, is light department. You know, their operating budget, counting power, is quite large. They're buying power in you know, $5 and $10 million increments almost daily. Well, not quite. So our treasury folks are very busy. And this is an opportunity with a retirement to upgrade, particularly the assistant treasurer position, to help out a little bit more, help out the treasurer a little bit more in that regard. When RMLD, was in place 20 years ago, their sophistication and the market sophistication was a lot lower. Power contracts were a lot different, a lot less fluid than they are today, a lot less volume. And our assistant collector manages a whole collector operation and does a great job. So that's the request in front of you, is just to finish off, if you will, the last year's pay in class by doing these two positions.
Questions from the board? Questions from the public? Hearing none, Mr. Secretary.
Move to close the hearing on amending the FY16 non-union classification plan.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor of closing the hearing? Motion carries 5-0. Mr. Secretary.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the amendments to the FY16 non-union classification plan as presented.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Vote is 5-0. The motion carries. Is there any more business to come before the board tonight?
I do want to bring to your attention, we had an item added yesterday to the December 15th agenda.
Yes.
We're going to ask you most likely for a 3-year extension on the assessing intermunicipal agreement with Wakefield. Not to spend too much time, but a year ago we thought there would be state legislation that would account for or accommodate this. So we were told not to do anything, not to go to town meeting, not to do anything. We gave it a year, we gave it 18 months. It's not happening. We're not going to wait any longer. We're very happy with the agreement.
Right.
I suggested to Wakefield 2 years. He says, how about 3? I don't see any reason why we wouldn't.
No.
So we're very happy. I think 30 months this December.
Just about 3 years. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's working out great. Excuse me?
2 cycles, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, given what he inherited, he's been phenomenal.
It's very thorough.
We outsource more, as most communities historically have done. I don't see any slippage in quality of data with that. We have 1.5 staff plus some clerical help. They're doing an awesome job.
Okay.
All right.
Is there
a
motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Move that the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 9:34 p.m.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
That's seconded. All in favor? 5-0. We stand adjourned. Until December 15th. Good night. This is Calabash, wherever you are.
I'm sorry.
Who remembers that?
You lost me on that one.
John.
I remember that.
Jimmy Durante.
We came to one of your other ones. Last one.
Although that was the 40s game.
Well.
That's where I began.
No, he was in the 50s.
Good decade.
Still think
we
still work.
My wife's telling me what a prestigious thing it was in the 70s to be dating a girl that had a color television at home.
There was, my parents waited till I was gone.
Really?
Before they had a color television, yeah. They said they needed to stop feeding me before they could afford one.
Don't want to give you any reason to stay.
You feed them, they stay. You give them health care, they stay. You feed them, they stay. All right.
She's seems like I had something else on my mind, but I'll
be probably ambling back.
You will?
I'm going to keep with your permission, sir.
No, go ahead. It's got to get done.
Yeah, we've got to clean up the end user there.
It's, when right, someone gentlemen. Takes a job, it's the one right. opportunity. Yeah. Yeah. Use your leverage, you lose it forever.
John, right. Everything settled in?
So well, he's going to leave. He's never going to threaten.
This has been going on since I
shouldn't say that.
My parents.
No.
He had the first one.
Yeah. From what we saw in our resumes, that people.
Then he had the second one.
Didn't generally leave it alone.
Right, exactly. That's an excellent point.
Yeah.
I got on a Saturday. I jumped on a plane on a Sunday. They're German. And I got a call on Tuesday night. He was down again.
I just
didn't come back. He came on a Wednesday. And he never came back.
That's what I'm going to tell him.
You could tell him that you told
him.
And I had already.
The rest of the lights weren't working.
Well, there was something going on. He couldn't speak. He couldn't. Control his airway. They talk about controlling your airway. You and I, as we go through our day, we.
It's a lie. You'll be making
this kind of stuff. It's unconscious.
I got to keep.
And it's kind of clearing that junk in your throat that collects from nothing.
So really, what you're
couldn't do that, so they had to suck it in every couple of hours, and then after a while, his eyes closed, I could see their eyes moving underneath the eyes.
Current chief was staying, a big bump up.
He was gone 2 days, and then.
Thank God it was fast.
I'm obviously gonna pull a heating tube, I said, that's inhumane, you can't do that.
That guy was here for what, 7 days?
Pulled it 2 hours, he's dead, it wasn't the food that killed him.
Yeah, that was.
He flipped the switch internally.
Well, you gave him permission.
He wants some jobs.
Well, it was right in his will.
That's what I'm saying, though, you know, it's like.
He said, look, no heroic measure shall be used.
That actually seems to really fit for your father. I really enjoyed just a brief chat with your mother.
By the way, she will talk to you.
I think Jimmy was.
Oh, I know, she's done that to me already before.
Loves to converse with people, and she's a good communicator, she's very strong.
And I explained to her, showed me Mass General, and I said, that's great, but town meeting has a.
We gotta go through a whole, what happens next on the old, it's gonna do that now.
And I'm happy to take the town meeting if that's what comes out of it.
Stay here, you wanna go somewhere else, where you wanna go, what kind of happened with the content, so we're gonna go through all that in the next year or so.
Yeah, well.
Give it a few months to settle.
I've been over that course with both of my parents, and it's a long and winding road, it doesn't, you know, none of it happens quick.
It's nice that all the kids.